Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Mark Griffin, Annie Wells and Marie McNair are joining us virtually today. May I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 6, 7, 8 and 9 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022 Amendment of Expiry Dates and Rent Cap Modification Regulations 2023 and the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act Early Expiry and Suspension of Provisions Regulations from 2023 from Patrick Harvey, the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights, the Scottish Government. And Mr. Harvey is joined for this item by the Scottish Government officials, Yvonne Gavin, who's a team leader at the Housing Services and Rented Sector Reform Unit. I'm going to, Adam, I'm sorry, but I'm not sure I can catch your name, but let's try. Adam Kravitz, Head of Housing, Homelessness and Regeneration at the Communities Analytical Division. Poppy Pryor, who's a lawyer, and Yvette Shepherd, who's the Head of Housing Services and Rented Sector Reform Unit. And I welcome the Minister and his officials to the meeting and invite him to make an opening statement.
Thank you and good morning, Convener. And I appreciate that the full titles of these instruments are a bit of a mouthful, but I'm very pleased to be here to present, as you said, the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2023 Early Expiry and Suspension of Provisions Regulations 2023 and the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022 Amendment. I've just realised there's a typo in my brief. The first title should have been the Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022 Early Expiry and Suspension of Provisions Regulations 2023. And the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022 Amendment of Expiry Dates and Rent Cap Modification Regulations 2023. Now, as Convener, yourself and committee members will remember, the Emergency Act that we introduced last year did have three key aims. Firstly, to protect tenants, stabilising their housing costs by freezing rents. Secondly, to reduce the impacts of eviction and homelessness through a moratorium on evictions. And thirdly, to avoid tenants being evicted from the rented sector by a landlord wanting to raise rents between tenancies during the temporary measures and to reduce unlawful evictions. The Act itself came into force on the 28th of October, and since then it's provided additional protection for tenants across the rented sector as we continue to live through these challenging and uncertain economic times. Last month, we published our first report on the operation of the Emergency Act, covering the period from coming into force until the end of December. And in that report, and in line with the requirements in the Act, we set out our intended position for the social rented sector rent cap post-March 2023. That's one of the that's the main focus of one of the instruments before you. Scotland has led and continues to lead the way in the delivery of affordable housing across the UK, with over 115,000 affordable homes since 2007 and equally ambitious targets over the next decade. Leading the way again within the UK, we've ended the right to buy to ensure that we retain social rented homes for people in the greatest need. And our commitment to affordable housing is second to none, and that's why we've placed so much emphasis on enabling continued investment in the delivery of high-quality social housing. During the passage of the Cost of Living Bill through Parliament, concerns were raised across the Chamber on the impact that a continued 0% rent freeze could have on that investment. Indeed, some of the members of the committee here today expressed those concerns. However, due to the unprecedented economic circumstances at the time, we felt it was imperative that all tenants living in the rented sector be afforded the protection provided by the emergency measures. But we agreed to work closely with social sector landlords. And indeed, we'd already, by the time the bill completed its passage through Parliament, we'd already established a short life task and finish group to support that work. That group comprising a number of key social sector landlord representative groups, including COSLA, the Scottish Housing, SFHA for short, and the Glasgow West of Scotland Forum, stressed the fine balance between affordability and investment, and the need to ensure that we set a social sector rents at a level that would ensure essential work can continue, such as new build programmes and work toward energy efficiency and carbon neutral targets. Now, they reached an agreement that would see increases of 6.4% in respect of local authorities' social housing and 6.1% for housing associations as an average across Scotland. It's important to note that the agreement of an average figure is essential to allow some degree of flexibility. The majority of rents will be increased at a level below the agreed 6.4% and 6.1% figures, but there may be some landlords who will, for specific reasons, need to go beyond those levels. In light of this, the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act Early Expiry and Suspension of Provisions Regulations 2023 expired the rent cap for the social sector from the 26th of February, enabling social landlords to set rent levels that they judge, in light of tenant feedback, to strike that balance on supporting repairs, maintenance, working towards meeting carbon neutral targets, and continuing to provide the wide range of support that they offer on a daily basis to their tenants in times of such pressure. Those regulations also make changes to the rent cap for the student accommodation sector. As laid out in the first report, feedback from stakeholders demonstrated that, in contrast to the mainstream private rented sector, the rent cap was having no impact on the student accommodation sector. This is because the nature of the majority of contractual student tenancy agreements means that rents are set annually, typically lasting the entire academic year, and rarely, if at all, allow for in-tenancy rent increases. In light of that feedback and in recognition that student accommodation tenancies are structured differently from other types of tenancies, we concluded that the rent cap should be suspended from the 30th of March and the early expiry and suspension of provision regulations seek to do so. However, I want to make it clear that by suspending the student accommodation rent cap instead of expiring it, ministers will continue to monitor the sector and do have powers to revive these provisions if fresh evidence shows that there would be benefit from doing so to deliver a necessary and proportionate response to the cost of living. Convener, I'd like to turn now to the affirmative instrument that you're considering today. Soon after we published our first report to Parliament, we laid the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022, Amendment of Expiry Dates and Rent Cap Modification Regulations 2023, along with a statement of reasons. In addition to the first report on the Act, which was laid before Parliament on the 12th of January, the Statement of Reasons sets out updated data and economic analysis, which shows that the unprecedented economic position has not yet changed fundamentally, and many households in the private rented sector in particular continue to struggle. Yesterday's announcement by Ofgem, indeed, on energy price caps from April this year will bring no consolation, despite the decreases, as the UK government measures mean that the average domestic energy bill will still increase from £2,500 to £3,000 at the same time as the £400 energy bill support scheme is ended, driving up fuel poverty to over 50% in the private rented sector. And it's for that reason that the Amendment of Expiry Dates and Rent Cap Modification Regulations seek to extend the rent cap measures for the private rented sector, as well as the eviction moratorium provisions across all rented sectors covered by the Act, and the other important provisions in the Act, for a further six-month period to the 30th of September. On the continuation of the private sector rent cap measures, while the focus continues, of course, to be on protecting tenants, we also recognise that the ongoing impacts of the cost crisis may be having on some private landlords. That's why these regulations propose that the rent cap be varied to allow for within-tenancy rent increases of up to 3%. The voluntary approach to rent setting taken by landlords in the social sector is intended to equate to an approximate average rental increase of less than £5 per week across the country. Now, as rents in the private rented sector are generally significantly higher, allowing for a maximum rent increase of 3% here equates to a similar average rent increase for tenants in a two-bedroom property, which is the most common property size in the private rented sector. We consider that this gives a measure of parity in monetary terms while continuing to protect tenants from unaffordable rent increases. There is also, of course, a safeguard for private landlords who could alternatively opt to apply for to apply to Rent Service Scotland for a rent increase of up to 6% if they have an increase in their defined prescribed property costs within a specified period. Turning to the proposed continuation of the eviction moratorium provisions, tenants in both the private and social rented sector, as well as those living in student accommodation, will continue to benefit from the additional time to find alternative accommodation provided by the six-month pause in the enforcement of eviction action. And in addition, they're protected from private landlords seeking to end a tenancy to raise rents above the cap and reduce unlawful evictions by increasing the level of damages payable. As with the rent cap, the eviction moratorium provisions include a number of safeguards for landlords. These recognise that there are some circumstances where enforcement of an eviction order or decree should be able to proceed to protect communities, for example, in instances of serious antisocial behaviour, as well as to strike the appropriate balance between the protection of tenants and the rights of landlords. In summary, Convener, we believe that the evidence showing that the cost crisis is very much still with us means that it's crucial that we continue some of the protections brought in by the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Act beyond the 30th of March this year. And as promised during the passage of the bill through Parliament, we have kept the measures under review and continue to consider their ongoing necessity and proportionality. We've used our powers to make changes to the Act where the evidence showed that it was required. That's what the two instruments before you today are seeking to achieve. So thank you, Convener, for the time being available to introduce these measures. Thank the committee for their scrutiny, and I look forward to any questions that members have.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that detailed opening statement. We've got a number of questions, and you may have touched on some of them, but I think we'll ask the questions and it will give us an opportunity, and you an opportunity, to maybe open a little bit more deeper. I'm going to begin with a general question and just a bit of a framing. The committee heard concerns from witnesses last week that the measures in the Act are not addressing some of the fundamental housing problems in the housing system, such as a lack of supply of affordable housing, high initial rents of private rented rented homes, and homelessness provision. And Fenella Gabrish, who is trying to access private rented accommodation, told the committee the barriers that we face day to day to try and access property is horrific. I'd be interested to hear from the Minister how the Emergency Act fits into what the Scottish Government is doing on affordable housing and on renting reform, and specifically, how can we use the powers in the Emergency Act to give a bridge to that wider reform?
Thank you, Convener. As I think we discussed with a number of members during the debates in Parliament during the passage of the bill itself, there are, of course, connections between the emergency measures contained in the Act that's been passed and the longer-term work that the Scottish Government is taking forward through the New Deal for Tenants and the commitment to a new housing bill later this year. However, the emergency legislation, although there were strong expectations for it, and I think it delivered very important, necessary protection, couldn't deliver everything that people would have wanted from that longer-term legislative reform. In particular, the protections on rent levels are around in-tenancy rent increases. They don't apply to the setting of new rents for new tenancies, and that's, I think, well understood through the debates that we've had on the legislation. The longer-term work on rent controls is ongoing, and we're keen to engage with the sector. And when I say the sector, I mean both landlord and tenant interests, of course, as well as those academics who can bring their expertise to bear on the way that the rental market works in housing. We're doing this in line with our commitment to the ethos that I think comes across well in Housing to 2040, that housing, the right to adequate housing, is a human right. And I think that we'll have a great deal more to say in due course. In relation to these measures, though, and the measures in the Emergency Act, the principal bridging mechanism that's been built in between the emergency legislation and the longer-term work is the power to alter the system of rent adjudication. We believe that if we moved directly from these emergency measures, switched them off entirely at some point in the future, and simply moved directly back into open market comparisons for rent adjudication, there would be severe unintended consequences. And so in due course, we'll bring forward proposals for how we intend to use those powers in the Act.
Thanks very much, and thanks for highlighting the fact that it's the rent adjudication that will create that bridge between what we have now and what you're bringing forward. On the rent cap, I'm interested to hear why the Scottish Government has, and you did touch on this in your opening statement, but opportunity for more. Why has the Scottish Government taken a different approach to the continuation of the rent cap between different sectors, and how proportionate and fair is this approach?
Yes, as again was debated during the passage of the bill, we recognise that the two parts of the rented sector, the two dominant parts of the rented sector, the social rented sector and the private rented sector, do operate differently. In particular, the social rented sector has a long tradition and indeed requirements for consultation and engagement with tenants in relation to rent setting. We wanted to respect that necessary and valuable engagement and consultation. We know that rental income provides not necessarily for profit. Indeed, social landlords are not profit-making bodies, but for investment in new build, in retrofit for energy efficiency and net zero, as well as for maintenance and upgrades of existing properties and a wide range of other services that social landlords provide in the community. And they plan those investments over a long time frame. And so as a number of members echoed concerns from across the sector during the passage of the bill, I think most people recognised that some short-term protection was necessary, but that if it continued at a 0% cap for an extended period, this would not only reduce rental income in the year of the cap's operation, but would have a compound impact on the financial planning of social landlords for a much longer period of time than that, and would have a detrimental impact on tenants because of that reduced investment. These factors don't apply in the same way to the private rental sector, which tends to be profit-making, and in which, for example, we already see a lower level of energy efficiency than in the social rented sector due to some properties not having been upgraded in the way that will be required in the future through the new build heat standard, as well as through the heat in buildings regulations around retrofit of existing properties. So in the absence of some of those factors that apply in the social rented sector, we felt that it was appropriate. It was also necessary because in the absence of large organisations representing private landlords, we have a diverse and fragmented sector in the private rented sector, there was no opportunity to negotiate a voluntary agreement with private landlords that would have achieved the same effect as the agreement that I'm pleased to say we reached with the social rented sector. So a mixture of recognising the different factors, the different characteristics of the two parts of the rented sector, as well as the differences in opportunity to achieve a voluntary agreement and the nature of how rents are set. All of these factors led us to recognise that a different approach had to be taken. But I would again place some emphasis on the broad level of parity that we're talking about. Because private rented sectors are significantly higher, we believe that there'll be, in monetary terms, roughly speaking, a parity between the rental increase that will be allowable for that most common type of property, the two-bedroom property in the private rented sector.
Thank you very much for that response. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with some questions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and your team. It's just to continue that discussion there, Patrick, with you. We heard the committee last week about these below inflation rent rises will provide challenges for social landlords in terms of improving homes and retrofitting. You mentioned that yourself there. Have we been able to do any kind of assessment of the impact of that? Because it's bound to have an impact in the immediate years to follow. And what can we possibly do to assist? Is there any consideration of additional resource, perhaps, to assist with that particular problem?
Well, the impact is a matter that's been subject to concern from the social rented sector, but I think we've been very pleased at the ability that we've had to reach agreement with the sector, and indeed the average approach, the approach of not setting a cap, not even seeking a voluntary uniform cap for the social rented sector, but instead offering an average, does allow for some flexibility. There will be some social landlords who have urgent need to invest in quality and maintenance, as well as other aspects of their investment programme. There'll be those who have managed more successfully than others to keep rents low and under control during the pandemic, for example. They won't all have followed exactly the same path because obviously they are independent bodies. And so given the different circumstances that different social landlords were in, I think it was appropriate that we allow some degree of flexibility. But social landlords exist for a social purpose. They're not there to extract the maximum rent that they can from the properties that they have on offer. And I think they take that social purpose very seriously. And I think none of them would be seeking to impose unaffordable rent increases or rent increases that can be reasonably avoided. And in fact, some of the early indications that we're seeing from the rents that are being set are significantly below. I've seen figures from some of the local authorities that have set their rent increases for the coming year at 2, 3, 4%, significantly below the average that we've been seeking. And I think we anticipate that will continue to be the case. The Scottish Housing Regulator will continue to give us information on that.
I presume they may have been knocking on your door to request or ask for consideration for additional resource, but will we keep an eye on that just to invite some kind of data gathering to help us understand how this is progressing and what the impact is actually over the next few years, so that we can be in a position to adjust if necessary in future years when times are a little bit better, let's hope.
Absolutely. And The commitment to social housing from the Scottish Government remains very strong. I think there's always been an understanding that the targets for new provision within the current decade would be likely to be backloaded to some extent. The impact of construction costs is obviously affecting that as well. But we continue to maintain that commitment to work with the social rented sector to understand not just the impact that this legislation may have had and may continue to have, but the wider necessity to provide the high quality, net zero and sufficient social housing that Scotland needs.
Okay, thank you. And we also heard last week from the regional network of tenants who were reminding us that the issue isn't just about rent, it's the whole cost of housing that they mentioned to the committee, and they included things like service charges and energy costs too that are falling on them that need to be looked at. Is that something that the government is aware of, that the wider impact that some of these issues, economic issues, are bringing to bear? Is that something that we've given some consideration to, and is there anything we can do about that to assist?
Yes, and just to reinforce the emergency legislation, we've never suggested that it's a solution to every aspect of affordability in the rental market. We believed it was necessary to prevent some very, very significant rent increases that we were becoming aware of, and to protect people in the throes of this very extreme cost of living crisis. But the longer term goal of having a broader and deeper understanding of what affordability really means in housing is about acknowledging those wider costs, and it will cover issues such as service charges and utilities that Willie Coffey raises. But I think a genuinely comprehensive understanding of affordability is also about place. It's about things like transport costs. It's about energy costs, as we've talked about. So it does require that longer term work, and I think Housing to 2040, as well as our commitment to legislation in this area, will continue to deliver on those aspirations.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Convener.
Thank you, Willie. And we're now going to go to Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. The committee's heard from a number of private landlords with regards to investor confidence in the sector being knocked, and what they believe will be a significant number of landlords seeking to leave the market. So I just wanted to ask what assessment's been made by the Scottish Government on the impact the private rent cap will have, and also if there's any data which you could share with us specifically around urban and rural and island, if you have that.
Yes, I mean, there is obviously a longer term argument that can be had, and I'm sure, I think we've had this argument played out in the chamber on a couple of occasions about whether a regulated approach to private renting is compatible with continued investment. Our view, and in fact I think the view of the cross-party group on housing, their report on rent control, acknowledged that regulated markets can be attractive to investors, and indeed we regularly make the case that over the long term, you know, the history of the devolved approach to housing, for example, we've seen a very substantial increase in the size of the private rented sector at the same time as continued improvements in the robustness of regulation. So we don't believe that there's a fundamental contradiction between having a well-regulated sector that strikes appropriate balances for tenants' rights and having continued investment in the sector. As far as current data shows, we do have, although it's not a statistical source, it's more an administrative source of data, the Scottish Landlord Registration Scheme, which shows that in December 2022, there were 340,149 private rented properties registered in Scotland. And that's slightly more than the 339,632 that were registered in August before the introduction of the rent cap. And just yesterday I was told that we've seen the figures for January, and it's roughly the same. It's still very slightly up, not significantly, but very slightly up on the August figure. Now, of course, there will be those who will suggest that there's an intention at some future point for landlords to leave the private rented sector. I think, though, it's fair to say that we hear that from Scotland, and we hear it from south of the border as well. And some of the push factors there have involved tax changes that the UK government has pursued, which impact on landlords' profitability throughout the UK. There are severe challenges in the housing system throughout the UK, and severe challenges to affordability. We believe it's necessary and achievable to strike the right balance between protecting tenants in terms of affordability through regulation, as well as ensuring that we have continued investment in housing supply.
Thank you for that. And I don't know if the Scottish Government have live data on this, which you could share with us as a committee as well. I think it's as we approach the September date, especially to see how potential changes and individual landlords' decisions will impact. I think that's maybe the critical point. I wanted to return to a question which the convener asked with regards to the setting of 3% and the suggestion which Scottish Property Federation made in their evidence, that they suggested this should be closer to 5%. And given inflation and what the Minister's outlined, why that 6% average for social sector wasn't closer for the private rented sector?
Yes, well, as I said in my opening remarks and reinforced to the convener, we believe that we have struck a balance which does achieve a degree of parity. Private rented sector rents are significantly higher than social rented sector rents, and so 3% in the private rented sector is broadly equivalent to what the impact would be, I think £5 a week or thereabouts in the social rented sector, if we look at the most common property type, the two-bedroom property. Obviously, there'll be slight variation for one-bedroom properties or for three- or four-bedroom properties, that average isn't something that we can apply at a uniform level. We need to control each individual rent individually to achieve that. But setting this 3% cap does achieve something which is broadly in parity in monetary terms. And of course, I would also reinforce that the additional safeguard for landlords is there. They can apply for an increase of up to 6% through Rent Service Scotland if they are facing additional prescribed property costs during the specified period. And I think that does strike the appropriate balance between landlords who will, in some cases, not in all cases, but in a significant number of cases, be facing significant challenges through the cost of living crisis, but also on tenants. Tenants tend, on average, to have lower incomes than those living in other tenures. Tenants in the private rented sector, they tend to spend a higher proportion of their income on their rent and are facing a number of other challenges. And we believe that this legislation strikes the appropriate balance going forward.
Thank you for that. You touched upon students, and I wanted to ask with regards to Edinburgh specifically. As an Edinburgh MSP, I've never known it so bad in terms of people contacting me to say that they can't find any property available, the levels of homelessness in the capital going up, the number of people now living in temporary accommodation, that's highest ever, including the record number of children and pregnant women in temporary accommodation. So the third outcome you mentioned of limiting homelessness doesn't seem to have necessarily helped in the capital. But with regards to students, I am concerned that this autumn, when they return, there will not be the accommodation available, because many properties, when students are moving out, are going straight into longer term, people who are working here in the capital. What assessment have you made of that, especially for Edinburgh, but with the universities as well, and the messages which were put out last term to say, if you don't have accommodation, don't matriculate?
Well, we do have to continue to engage with the universities around the obligations that they have to look after the students that they choose to attract, whether from domestic students or indeed overseas students. We took the view that the specific measures in the emergency legislation in relation to the purpose-built student accommodation market were not having any significant effect, because the scope for in-tenancy rent increases was negligible to non-existent. And although the intention was always there to try and achieve parity of protection, we had to take the view that the impact of the specific measures on the rent cap in the purpose-built student accommodation sector was not having that effect, and so that's been suspended. In relation to the wider arguments, though, I think we've long acknowledged that there are deeper issues to explore in relation to student accommodation. That's why we have the current review ongoing. The members of the steering group for that review have been working hard. I think that's nearing completion, and we're expecting the steering group to give their recommendations to ministers, which we will then, of course, at the appropriate time, report to Parliament and give our response to. Myself and Mr Hepburn, the Minister responsible on the HE and FE side, will continue to engage with each other across government and with the education sector around these issues.
Thank you. Have you had universities, though, contacting Scottish Government to express their concerns on this issue?
I'm not aware of contact that we've had recently from the universities on that.
Education colleagues are in ongoing dialogue with the universities and colleges, but no specific to us.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
And I would finally just add, because Miles Breg mentioned homelessness, that if we look at the tenures from which homelessness referrals are coming, obviously there's been an extended period for a number of years where the private rented sector was significantly higher source of homelessness than other tenures. That reduced significantly during the emergency legislation for COVID, but has had a continual rise and now exceeds, or prior to the introduction of this emergency legislation, was now exceeding its pre-COVID levels. That increase hadn't been seen from other tenures, and so we do have an issue in relation to eviction from the private rented sector as a source of homelessness, and that's another reason why we believe that the measures, particularly on protection from eviction, remain necessary.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camille.
Thanks, Miles. And we're now going to move online with questions from Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Camilla. I'd just like to declare an interest as an owner of a private rented property in the North Lanarkshire Council area. Good morning, Minister. You've touched on some of my areas of question in your opening statement and in answers to the Camilla. But I just wonder if you want to expand further on the government's long-term plans to introduce private sector regulation and talk about perhaps how the transition between the emergency legislation and into further long-term rent controls might happen, and maybe give the committee a more definitive timescale on when you expect to introduce that legislation.
Yes, I think we confirmed fairly recently that the intention is to introduce that legislation as soon as we can after the summer recess this year. There are a number of areas where I think there's a very clear public expectation from stakeholders about the provisions in that plan, particularly around homelessness prevention. We've also signalled through the New Deal for Tenants a number of other areas where we expect to make progress. The New Deal for Tenants not only talked about the development of a national system of rent controls, but also about other tenants' rights. For example, you know, some of the softer things which just give people a sense of dignity at home, like the ability to personalise their home or to keep pets. We've also talked about some of the more challenging issues, such as protection from evictions during the winter months. So the legislation that we will introduce to Parliament later this year will address a number of these measures and others. And I think the recognition across political parties about the value of the approach taken in Housing to 2040 is important to flag up here as well. This approach to not only developing plans extensively with stakeholders and with the public, but trying to create a long-term vision about the role that housing plays in meeting wider policy objectives for people in Scotland, from tackling poverty and inequality to creating and supporting jobs, looking at issues around demographics and depopulation, as well, of course, as our hugely important targets to emission reduction and net zero. So I think between the Housing Bill and the Heat and Buildings Bill, we'll be addressing all aspects of that.
Yeah, thanks for that, Minister. The other area I wanted to cover was an issue that SFHA raised last week, and that was about mid-market rent being covered by the private sector rent cap. I just wonder what the government's view is of mid-market rent being both part of the affordable housing supply programme and also covered by the private sector rent cap, and wonder as well, considering their comments last week, whether the government are considering amending the type of tenancy and mid-market rent in the housing bill that you plan to bring forward after recess.
Yeah, thanks. It's a very good question, and we acknowledge that there are again, differences in the nature of mid-market rent, both in the rent levels, but also in what's included within rent, for example, issues in relation to service charges and others. And while we took the view very clearly that in relation to the emergency legislation, mid-market rent properties tended to be private residential tenancies and would be treated as private residential tenancies in terms of the Act, we recognise that there are longer-term issues to work through before we get to the introduction of the new housing bill and a national system of rent controls. We're keen to engage with the social rented sector to understand their concerns about that and to identify the appropriate way to address those concerns.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks, Mark. And we're going to stay with another member online and bring in Annie Wells.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. Why do you think extending the evictions pause is necessary and proportionate, given that landlords generally pursue eviction as a last resort? And there are existing precautions already in place, such as the need for landlords to comply with rent arrears pre-action requirements.
Thank you. I'll maybe start just by reinforcing the comments that I made earlier about the pattern of evictions from different tenures that I spoke about to Miles Briggs. For quite a long time, eviction from the private rented sector was extremely dominant as a source of new homelessness. That began to come under control again, but remained high pre-pandemic. And the emergency legislation in relation to COVID significantly reduced that. Since that time, and before the introduction of the Cost of Living Act, we saw a very, very steady, very marked increase in homelessness coming from the private rented sector. We didn't see that same effect happening from either local authority or RSL social housing. And so there is a recognition that something very significant and harmful has happened there in relation to sources of homelessness. Now, we took the view fundamentally that the economic situation has not markedly changed from the time that we introduced this legislation, and the necessity for a level of protection, not only from a pause on eviction to allow people more time to find new accommodation if that's what they're facing, but also the very significant measures to create disincentives for unlawful eviction. Unlawful eviction remains a very serious problem in Scotland, and the very, very low level of penalty that landlords previously faced meant that they didn't really find that disincentive. So we've made it easier and more relevant for tenants who are being faced with unlawful or unreasonable eviction to take action to protect themselves from that. So both the moratorium and those additional protections through the measures against unlawful eviction, we believe, remain necessary in the current circumstances. In fact, I think the concern that's been raised from other members about availability of rented housing in some parts of the country, if anything, reinforce, in my view, that the sense of necessity for those measures.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Annie. Now we're going to move to questions from Paul McLennan.
Can I just declare an interest? I am an owner of a rental property to my in-laws in East Lothian. Thanks, Minister. Last week, we had Shelter Scotland express concerns about the... I suppose the rent arrears around about being evicted for rent arrears over £2,250. It called for this amount to be increased, as evidence from its laws service showed that the work on eviction cases showed the average amount was about £5,700. I'm just wondering if you gave any consideration to increasing that figure.
Again, this is an issue which we debated, and I think during the debates on the bill, I reflected on the factors that we try to weigh up in reaching an approach on rent arrears. The support that tenants in very severe rent arrears need, in my view, is not just to be stuck where they are building up ever more rent arrears. The support that they need is, for example, through the Tenant Grant Fund and other forms of financial support, and the ability to work with their landlord in a constructive way to resolve the reasons why they're in rent arrears and work out the best way forward for them. So the approach that we've taken in setting the level of severe rent arrears that we've set out, we think gives the appropriate level of protection without simply leaving people stuck where they are, building up ever more unaffordable rent arrears. And those arrears, you know, if they reach a level of severity significantly beyond what we've currently set out, would themselves be extremely destructive and disruptive to a person's circumstances going forward, even if they did stay where they were or move to another property, those debts become a burden which we think is unreasonable. So the type of protection that people facing those arrears need, I think, is not simply stay where you are and see those arrears grow ever more.
Okay, thanks. Minister, the second question was really just talking about, I suppose, the Act itself doesn't provide any data on changes in homelessness over the period the Act has been in force. The report in the Act doesn't provide any data on changes in homelessness over the period that the Act has been in force. Can you say any more about the impact and measures on protecting tenants from homelessness? I know you're expecting any increases in homelessness as the 6 months restriction on enforcement of eviction orders comes to an end.
Well, the provisions, in our view, very clearly, almost by definition, will have prevented some rented sector households from falling into homelessness by, as I said, giving them extra time to find alternative accommodation or to seek housing advice and support from specialist agencies. For private rented sector tenants, also, the measures continue to provide protection by making it easier and more meaningful, as I said, to challenge unlawful eviction, and that indeed unlawful eviction is the type of experience that people can go through which is more likely to lead to homelessness. In fact, I count myself among the number. I narrowly avoided homelessness when I was evicted from a flat by a dodgy landlord before some of the current protections were in place, long before some of the current protections were in place. And so I take very seriously the impact on people's lives when they encounter those kind of behaviours, those kind of practices. The longer-term work, of course, on homelessness prevention duties is, I think, long awaited by the sector, and we've engaged extensively with stakeholders to make sure that we're going to be bringing forward measures that will help to strengthen the protection against homelessness and to reduce that. I'm not sure, Adam, if we have any current data that you want to throw into the conversation around current patterns.
We published homelessness data at the end of January, but as you say, there's a bit of a time delay between when local authorities provide us with the record level data. So the data we published in January just took us to the end of September. So the next release will be around July time, which will take us to the end of March, which will cover the period covered by the Act. The statistics we published in January did show increasing trends across homelessness and across use of temporary accommodation. But the publication provides an insight into where the homelessness cases are coming from. So it's not just the private rented sector, it's people wanting to live, leave their parental homes, you know, there's relationship breakdown, there's a whole analysis published on the website as to the causes of homelessness. The increase of households coming from the private rented sector and presenting as homeless may or may not be due to eviction. There could be other reasons why somebody chooses to leave or to present as homeless. So I don't think we can pin it down to evictions, but we can pin it down to the previous tenure and the main reason why people are presenting as homeless.
Okay. Thanks, Adam. Thanks, Minister.
Thank you.
Thanks, Camilla.
Thank you, Paul. We're now going to move back online and bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and your team. The committee heard from Shelter Scotland that advisers report that tenants are unclear about the rights in relation to the Act. They say there's kind of a lack of clarity on the eviction provisions, where the Scottish Government messaging is causing a bit of confusion. How would you respond to those concerns, and what more can you do to ensure tenants and landlords are aware of their rights under the Act and future changes?
Yes, I thank the member for the question. I was aware of the criticisms that were raised by Shelter. I would very much welcome any further dialogue that we can have with Shelter or other agencies. I think Citizens Advice Scotland were discussing some of the same issues and hear their ideas about what more we can do. But I would draw attention to a significant amount of work that we have done, both during the development of the New Deal for Tenants and particular focused activity around the Cost of Living Act, not just conventional news releases and activity across conventional media, but a wide range of social media content. The renters' rights website was updated and advertised widely. We've had information available through in the context of wider cost of living information, including distribution through GP surgeries, libraries, community centres, leisure centres, and that's included numbers and contact details for organisations that can offer individual advice and support, not just generic information about the provisions in the legislation. That information has, of course, included both Shelter and Citizens Advice Scotland. There's also been direct communication through key partner organisations such as tenant and landlord representative bodies, social landlords, local authority landlords, educational establishments, and that's given tenants the information that they need on the new legislation, as well as how to access more information should they need it. We've also had direct communication with registered landlords via local authorities' text messaging alert and direct communication with registered letting agents as well. And there's also been engagement with the three tenancy deposit schemes to facilitate dissemination of information with tenants who registered on their newsletters. And there's been a direct message to an extensive list of stakeholders, including colleges and universities and PBSA providers, confirming the nature of the measures and giving information for tenants. But as I say, we'll continue to be very open to further suggestions about more activity that we could take forward on this. And particularly as changes come through, I know that that landlords as well as tenants will continue to have questions about what these changes mean for them, and we're keen to make sure that they have access to the answers they need.
Thanks, Minister. That information is really useful to the committee. Convener, I don't have any other questions. My other questions covered. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Marie. I've got a couple of things I wanted to... I just want to kind of continue that a little bit, but... more from the social rented sector side, I've been made aware that since this act came in the social, in this is one social rented sector housing. I'm aware you are in discussions with them, but they've had an experience where people are getting the wrong message. The tenants are getting the wrong message, and their rent, they've seen an increase by 1.16% in rent arrears. That figure is higher than any other reporting period in a previous financial year. And what they were saying to me is that people think they can just stop paying their rent, and then that they're, as tenants, they're increasing, they're increasingly going to arrears, which they will have to pay. So there's something there about messaging and communicating what's really happening with this act and other measures going forward. I just wonder if you're in discussion with the housing associations about that.
Yes, we're obviously in regular dialogue with them. I think I have seen some media reports, for example, which haven't quite captured the full detail. If an announcement is made about what's going to happen to the level of the cap, for example, not every media report quite captures properly the difference between the impact on the social and the private rented sector. That's why we need to continue to work directly with the social landlords, for example, who have that ongoing responsibility for consultation and tenant engagement, as well as with private landlord representative bodies and organisations that speak directly to tenants and advocate on their behalf. I think it's also worth reflecting that the organisations that engage with tenants in the social rented sector who are not social housing providers, such as the Tenant Information Service, as well as some of the work that local authorities have done, such as Glasgow's tenant-led housing... is it a panel, they call it? Commission. Tenant-led housing commission. I'm actually going to be seeing some of them later this week. They also have a continued role in making sure that they let us know about additional channels of communication we should be using, but also in speaking directly to tenants, and they've been very active in doing so.
Thank you very much for that. It's good to hear that you're connected with that issue and proactive on it. And I agree with you, the nuance of this doesn't necessarily get conveyed in the media. I've got one final question, which would be interested to hear about the relationship between increasing intervention and regulation on private renting, both over the last 20 years, and the experience of other European countries.
Yeah, I think when we've previously debated not so much this legislation, but the New Deal for Tenants, this is clearly an area where there's some ideology comes into the debate a little bit. I think there are those who see the view that a more deregulated, more free market approach to housing will increase supply, and that any level of impact on prices is going to be detrimental to that. Actually, if we look at some European countries, which have had systems of rent controls in place for a long time, we actually see a larger private rented sector than in terms of proportion of the housing stock than we see in Scotland. That's not universal experience, and I think it's well understood that rent controls can achieve their objectives well or poorly. We are continuing to engage with all stakeholders to ensure that we design a system that is right for Scotland and that it's going to be able to achieve protection in terms of affordability, but is also going to be consistent with what Scotland needs in terms of good quality of housing supply, as well as investment in all of the hugely important priorities around transition to net zero. And there is a connection between rental income and investment in either sector. That relationship between rental income and investment isn't the same in the social rented sector, which, as I said earlier, is a non-profit-making sector, as it is in the private rented sector. There are examples of build-to-rent, but a great deal of private rented accommodation isn't actually provided by landlords. It's acquired by them. It's not necessarily built by them. It's acquired by them as existing properties. So there are huge differences between the sectors, and we're keen to continue to do the work that we've been taking forward since the publication of the New Deal for Tenants, and that will continue to be in development until the bill is introduced later this year. And I look forward to further extensive dialogue with the committee at that point.
Thank you very much, Minister. Yes, and I'm sure we all look forward to that coming forward too. So thank you so much for your evidence today. And we now turn to agenda item 3, which is consideration of the motion on the instrument. And I invite the Minister to move motion S6M07703, that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022 amendment of expiry dates and rent cap modification regulations 2023 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. Do members have any points that they wish to make? Miles.
Thank you. I'm not going to rehearse the arguments we made in the chamber with regards to our concerns to the legislation, but just to put on record once again that it is clear that this has impacted on both the social and private rented sector and very much destabilised them. I think that's not necessarily my words, but the sector when they've been expressing their concerns. And I welcome some of the changes which the Scottish Government have brought forward, but we will not be supporting it today. Thanks.
Thank you, Miles. Anybody else? No. Minister, is there anything you wish to add?
I don't think so. I think we've covered the main arguments that needed to come across.
Thank you. The question is that motion S6M07703 in the name of Michael Matheson be approved. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of the motion, please raise your hands, or if you're on blue jeans, press Y in the chat function. Okay. And those against the motion, please raise your hands if you're in the room. And if on blue jeans, press N in the chat function. Okay. And those abstaining, please raise your hands or press A in the chat function on blue jeans.
We've got everybody, haven't we?
Yeah. Okay. Okay, the result of the division is 5-4, 2 against, and the motion is therefore agreed. The committee will publish a report setting out its recommendations on the instrument in the coming days. The next item in our agenda for today is consideration of two negative instruments, the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022, Early Expiry and Suspension of Provisions Regulation 2023, and the Local Government Scotland Act 2004, Remuneration Amendment Regulations 2023. There's no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Do members have any comments on the instruments? Nobody has any comments. Is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instruments?
Agreed.
We're agreed. Thank you. I now suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence from two panels of witnesses on community planning inquiry post-legislative scrutiny of the Community Empowerment Act 2015. This is our first session on the inquiry, and the inquiry is looking at the impact of the Community Empowerment Act 2015 on community planning and how community planning partnerships respond to significant events such as the COVID-19 pandemic and the current cost of living crisis. We are joined on our first panel of witnesses by Carol Calder, who's the Audit Director at Audit Scotland, Stuart Graham, who's a representative from Community Planning Network, and Tim Mackay, who's the Deputy Chair at the Accounts Commission. We've received apologies from Councillor Heddle, who is the Vice President of COSLA. He was to have joined the panel today, but is unable to attend. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. We'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible, but if you'd like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks. Each committee member will be exploring a particular theme, and Annie Wells will be starting our discussion this morning by asking you some questions about the challenges that communities face. And Annie, I should say, three of our members are online, so we'll be going to questions coming from people online. So Annie Wells.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. What are the main challenges faced by communities across Scotland? And have these changed in the years since the Act was passed in 2015? And I'm looking at the particular example of the COVID pandemic. And also looking ahead, what role should CPPs have in supporting communities during the cost of living crisis? And I'll put that to Stuart first. Thank you.
Okay. Shani, nice to see you again. So thanks for that question about the challenges that are facing our communities. I think you've correctly identified the cost of living as cost of living crisis as the current challenge. I think there's also a big challenge in terms of climate change as well that I think communities are becoming increasingly aware of. I think one of the things that we've noticed through our work on cost of living is that, you know, part of community planning is about trying to look upstream at the causes of things as well as trying to address things in the here and now. And we're looking at the nature of poverty and some of the ways in which that's changed over the last sort of 10, 15, 20 years or so. And I think one of the changes that we've noticed is that way back, you would probably have thought of poverty as being almost synonymous with unemployment. And if you were in a job, you were probably in a reasonably good place or had the platform to progress with your life. But now I think increasingly we're realising that the research has shown us that much of the people who are experiencing poverty are actually in work as well. So that is a different challenge. What we have done in terms of addressing the cost of living crisis is we've worked with our community planning partners. So I come from a council background, but we've worked quite strongly with our third sector partners and with our other partners in employability spheres to try and address that. I think what we have to do is understand how it impacts differently on, so we speak about our communities, but our communities have different communities within them. And I think that was especially the case with the response to COVID as well. So one of the pieces of work that's been done in our community planning partnership, but probably across most of them in Scotland, has been trying to look at the differential impact on different communities of the COVID crisis and how that's impacted differently on people, and then try to develop what we term in Renfrewshire a social renewal plan to address those kind of specific elements of it. In terms of what we can do as a community planning partnership, I think we can make use of all the intelligence that our various different partners have got. So we will engage with our communities individually in different ways, but if we can collectively bring that experience and knowledge together, then we form a better picture of how we can then work together to address the issues that they face. So there's a learning and listening aspect to our community planning. And then I think there's a deliberative aspect of what we're actually going to do to mitigate the circumstances and then hopefully address the upstream practices as well.
just to speaking from the Accounts Commission point of view, which is more focused on local authorities, I think one of the big issues that's come out of COVID, or rather will follow from COVID, is that the funding for local authorities local authorities are struggling for a sustainable funding stream, and that has a knock-on effect, obviously, when it comes down to community planning. The other aspect is that actually a lot of good things happened during the COVID pandemic. Local authorities were very flexible in their response, and so one of the perhaps not issues, but one of the points that we make is that a lot of that good practice and a lot of those good things may disappear after COVID, after we recover from COVID. So we would like to hope that actually that good practice will continue in the future.
Karen, you want to add some?
Just to add to that, I think that the way that community planning partnerships can help communities is by working collaboratively. I think the issues that affect affect the communities can't be resolved by one agency, the council alone. I think there has to be more collaboration about working together, how the resources, the public sector resources in the place in the community can be used to best effect, whether that's about data, as Stuart mentioned, and understanding communities well, but also working collaboratively to redesign services and improve inequalities.
Thanks very much for those answers, panel. I just want to talk about inequalities now as well, because data collected by the Improvement Service shows massive inequalities between communities in the same local authority area. For example, between Springburn and Maryhill and Kelvin Side and Georgian Hill in Glasgow, reducing inequalities is a core purpose of community planning. So how successful has that been?
So I think
whoever wants to take that one first.
Yep, certainly. I think is the way that the legislation was framed in terms of making inequalities a particular duty of community planning was helpful, because it's helped, you know, focus the fact that it's everyone's duty to do that. As Carol said, not just the council but all the other partners as well. I think one of the things we have to bear in mind is that, if you like, many of the wicked issues that we face are moving targets. So it's not that we've got an issue that we have to address and then that issue stays the same until you've actually addressed it. So inequalities is a moving feast. I think what we try to do is really sort of focus on lived experience of people that are impacted by those inequalities, work out what the differences are between some of those communities that you're speaking about. And now, much more so than maybe previously, we talk about environmental justice, we talk about justice in terms of the ways that our communities are served by various different agencies as well. So one of the things that we're looking to do is build together some consistency and cohesion in terms of how we treat and react to our communities, and that can be communities of place who maybe experience poverty as evidenced through the SIMD, Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, or it could be communities of interest, and particularly things like disability groups and race equality groups as well. And what we have to do as public agencies, and as Carol was saying, the more we act together, then the better we can do that, is by listening to those communities and listening to the changes and the demands that they make and the things that they're experiencing, and try and focus on that. As Tim said, that's very often a question of resources as well, and we need to focus where we put those resources. But having that impetus, if you like, to reduce inequalities through community planning is helpful to us as partners in terms of shaping our response.
It's interesting that you started your question by referring to the data in inequalities. One of the issues that we found is that actually the quality of data that comes out from the community planning process isn't that good. So when we talk about improving outcomes, we really need to have data to show that all that activity is improving outcomes. And that data really isn't there at the moment.
Just to briefly add to that, that in the Commission's local government overview each year, we pull out case studies where councils have worked well with their partners to improve outcomes for local communities. And we have a lot of ground level projects and initiative evidence. But as Tim says, there's a bit of a gap between that and what's happened strategically in the community planning partnership and being able to demonstrate how their priorities and the action that's been taken against them, how that's improving the outcomes overall. So there is things happening at a local level, but a wee bit of a disconnect between how able partnerships are to demonstrate the overall improvements around the inequalities.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you for those responses. Stuart did touch on my next sort of a part of my question. I mean, we spoke about communities of place, and the guidance to Part 2 of the Act spoke about the impacts on communities of interest. And I think we mentioned people with disabilities, but we're talking about maybe young people leaving care, vulnerable adults as well. And I was just wondering, is there any evidence that community planning partnerships are identifying and engaging with these communities?
Yeah, I mean, I think there will be evidence through, as Carol said, some of the good practice that we've got through various different community planning partnerships that's in place, whether that's cohesive right across the community planning landscape, if you like. I couldn't say off the top of my head here, but I think one of the things that we do in some cases better now is, as I say, learn much more from the lived experience of those communities. Mm-hmm. And we talk about data, and I think Tim's right that there is maybe a gap in the data we've got sometimes, particularly about our inequalities communities. But where we can hopefully address some of those gaps is through actual day-to-day engagement with the communities. So it's things that aren't data evidence as yet, but they are experience that's coming through for people. I think what we have to bear in mind of is the interaction between different policy agendas. So if you like, we're pursuing the digital agenda at the moment, and try and get as many people online as possible. But we need to recognise that there's dangers there in terms of digital exclusion. And that is where community planning can come in as a focus, try and anticipate some of those inequalities and address them kind of at source. So I think on the ground, we're probably better at speaking to our various different communities than we were previously. But it's something that we really need to keep going and translate that knowledge and understanding into policy direction to narrow those inequalities.
Thanks very much for that, Stuart.
Just one thing to add. Stuart quite rightly referred to digital exclusion, and that's a topic we're very interested in. And this year we're doing a report on digital exclusion, just looking at those communities of interest who are often digitally excluded, you know, the aged, the poor, the young, and just seeing the impact that has had, particularly as during COVID, an awful lot of service has gone mm-hmm. digital, as it were. And so there's a danger that some people are being left behind because of that.
Thanks very much. I have no further questions, convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Annie. And that report sounds like that will be a very valuable piece of work and useful to be able to have a look at. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin on the theme of community empowerment. Mark.
Thanks, Camilla. Maybe come to Carol first. My question is just the Community Empowerment Act was supposed to give communities a bigger voice. It was supposed to give them a say over the services they rely on, start to build capacity in those communities, them to advocate on their own behalf. I just wonder if there's any evidence that has actually happened, and is it happening consistently over 32 local authority areas, or do you see a difference in performance across the country?
Thank you for that question. Our best value audit reports all look at community empowerment and partnership working in each individual council. And what we would say is that there is a very strong commitment from councils to engage with communities. So the various different ways of consulting can be around the budget, which is traditionally is done, but also around the cost of living crisis and other ways in which the communities have been involved. The pandemic, I think, was pretty much a turning point, because at that point, communities and councils were working together really well in order to meet the needs of the most vulnerable. And there are lessons to be learned around that. In answer to your question, I would say that the picture is mixed. The extent to which communities are actively involved in decision-making around services, reform of services, there's less evidence of that. But what I would say, there is much more evidence now of councils engaging with communities in the discussions about what their priorities are. And the Accounts Commission will be reporting on a national basis on the extent to which communities have been involved with councils developing their new priorities with the new council makeup. So that's work that's ongoing at the moment. So we'll be reporting that next year. So that will touch on some of the things that you're asking about. But I would say that the picture is varied across Scotland. There's less evidence of communities being involved in strategic change, but there is much more in the way of engagement and involvement in communities. And I think councils the better councils have built on what was achieved over COVID. And I think Tim mentioned earlier about we'd like to see that momentum sustained and not falling back, but there was certainly an increase in involvement.
Don't know if anyone else in the panel.
I think some of the things that we speak of is how influential communities feel. So do they feel they have an opportunity to A, have a voice, and B, impact on policy decisions that take place? And that can happen in a number of ways. I mean, that can happen through individual community groups, it can happen through community councils, it can happen through the third sector interfaces, and it's one of the things that, you know, that there is some evidence of, that some groups will feel more influence than others. I think there's some of the legislation about community empowerment, community asset transfer, for example, has probably been a bit easier to grasp for communities. So because a building or a piece of land is visible within a local community, then the extent to which a local community has a decision about what happens with that is very visible to them. Other parts of the legislation, I think, has been a bit more difficult for communities to grasp, and therefore you maybe see less of that in terms of community involvement. And the other thing that we are seeing increasingly more of, and indeed councils are being asked to deliver 1% of their budgets through participatory budgeting. So increasingly you're seeing more participatory budgeting exercises across Scotland, where people are having actually a direct vote on spending, and that's playing out across the piece.
Thanks for that, Stuart. That kind of leads me on to my next question about how empowered communities feel, because the Scottish Household Survey statistics kind of flag that communities feel less empowered, and I just wondered, come back again to Stuart, whether you think communities actually, you know, do people know what community planning partnerships are? Do they even know they exist, or what they do, and what perhaps can we do, or what can we be asking government to do to increase awareness of community planning partnerships, what they do, how people can get involved and start to have their voice heard when it comes to people making decisions about their own services?
One of these things that my own personal view, and it's maybe not the view of my other community planning colleagues, I don't know, is that community planning is sometimes the kind of invisible glue. So maybe it's maybe not something that we promote as something that's separate from the public service that they feel. And if community planning is working right, then maybe communities shouldn't know that those four or five partners have joined together and worked really hard to deliver a joined up service to them. I think what's more important is that they know how to get involved and how to influence decisions, and that can be from contact with their the local councillor, their MSP, their MP, or it can be through, you know, active involvement, through joining a local community group, or it could be influencing things through campaigns. So I think it's about individuals knowing that, you know, we're not asking them to be involved every single day and every single hour of the day, but when they need to get involved, that they know how to do that. And I think that's something that we could get better at. But certainly what we want to do is encourage community groups to get active, get organised, and if you like, get involved in solutions before they identify problems, because sometimes that's an issue, that it takes a problem before people will want to become empowered and get organised. And I think one of the questions is, empowered to do what? And it's for the communities themselves to say, right, this is what we want to see in our local community, and that's when we can work better together to support them. So I think there has been some positive move towards that. I'm not sure personally if we need to publicise or promote community planning partnerships as something different. What we just want to do is get people involved where they're comfortable at getting involved, so that it produces a better outcome for them at the end of the day, and that they can evidence that back to us.
Thanks, Stuart. Carol, you wanted to come in.
Just to say that I've got some anecdotal evidence that shows that sometimes the expectations, there's some perverse outcomes. So this was a real-life example, and it's some years ago now, but a community was involved in a big discussion about participatory budgeting, and it was quite an all-day session, and it was a very well run, and they had these kind of ask the audience buttons, so they had polls and things, and at the end of the poll they asked people, did they feel more empowered as a result of being involved in this initiative? And actually the data showed that they felt less empowered. And they were able, because they were in a room, to discuss this. And the reason they felt less empowered was because they had more of an understanding of all the decisions that councils make, what could be done, what services are provided. And so it opened up to them, well, there's all of that stuff that actually I'm not involved in. So sometimes you need to look behind the figures, because community engagement raises expectations, and there can be some perverse sort of findings from that. So it was just to illustrate.
Tim.
Just to add, you asked about how it's working across the country. Our best value reports over the last 5 years have all looked at participatory budgeting. And to be honest, it's a fairly patchwork sort of story. It's working a lot better in some places than others. And partly what it seems to be, it's not so much the community planning partnership, because people don't really, as you say, know what they are. It's really what the partners do to get the message across. So, you know, involving the public in the whole process, reducing bureaucracy, things like participation requests, for instance. That's, you know, the person in the street won't quite know what that is. But if the community planning partnership with the council explains it and invites people to participate, that's the key to getting them in.
Thanks very much for that. Mark, are you complete?
Yep, that's me. Thanks, Camino.
Thank you very much. We're now going to move on to the next theme, which is the role of the third sector. I just remind our panel that you don't need to operate your mics. We've got somebody here to do it for us. And I'm going to bring in Paul McLennan.
Thanks, convener, and thanks, panel. I want to touch on the role of the third sector, and I chair the cross-party group in social enterprises, so this has been picked up out with evidence sessions we've had here as well, and they're saying the same thing in terms of, I suppose it's a mixed picture across all local authorities in terms of how they see the community planning partnerships. They're all in agreement that it's a worthwhile exercise, but in terms of across the board, it's kind of mixed to how they see the participation and their involvement from local authorities. And I suppose the first question is really in terms of third sector participation, how you see the Act, has that been met, have the objectives of the Act been met in terms of that? And I suppose it's, what can we do then to ensure that I suppose, the growth in community planning partnerships and the well-being, I think, in terms of how the groups feel, how can that be sustained across all 32 local authorities? And I know the convener will be touching about locality plans. One of the things he touched about was on saying it was sometimes fine at that level. When it came down to locality, it didn't quite flow through. And I know that the convener will be touching on that, but that was the almost part of the context as well that came through. I don't know who wants to take that one.
I think the first part of your question was about the third sector and whether participation with the third sector...
Whether you think the ambitions of the Act have been met in terms of third sector participation?
We haven't done a lot of work on that, but I think there are challenges for the third sector, particularly just now with the cost of living crisis and Council's funding being really tight, is the extent to which their funding is going to be impacted by that. And they are also at the mercy of short-term funding as well. So their ability to kind of plan ahead and work on long-term projects with partners, I think, is inhibited by that. But we haven't done any specific work on whether, on any audit work on that. But I would say that the challenges that have impact on the council, inflexibility of funding, reducing funding, uncertainty, all impacts on the third sector as well, and that will be an inhibiting factor in their ability to engage with partners to deliver services.
Carol, thanks. Tim, just on that, Carol, you mentioned about the audit work. Is that something that would be considered in the future, for example? Because I know in the Best Value report, community planning is looked at, but it's more from a council point of view rather than saying how are they then involved in the third sector. And certainly the feedback we got was some third sector organisations thought it worked very well with the councils, some didn't. In terms of that. So I wonder if that would be future work that yourself and the Council Commission look at to see, look, how has that been embedded? And are councils doing enough to get this? And based, obviously taking into consideration what you're saying about the pressures, but are councils doing enough to embed the third sector into community planning, true community planning? Tim, I don't know what your thoughts on that one would be.
Through the local government overview last year, and we'll be reporting it this year, that'll be out in May, we talk about the importance of reform of services, service redesign, and that should be undertaken in conjunction with communities and the third sector, as well as other public sector partners. So we are beating that drum around involvement of the third sector. And we will be doing more work around reform and the extent that, to which councils are working with partners in its widest sense in the future as well. So that will have an element of the third sector. And I think Tim might be able to come in on some discussions the Commission have had with the sector itself.
Yes, I mean, generally our relationships are quite good with the third sector. I think the funding issue is crucial, and it's not so much, well, it's the amount, but it's also the continuity. You know, it's sort of, as you know, probably a hand-to-mouth existence year to year. So it's getting a more longer-term fiscal framework, as we keep referring to it as. Is part of the solution. But certainly, I mean, I sponsor the local government overview, so I take your point. We can perhaps look a little bit more closely at how councils are bringing the third sector into that community planning partnership.
Stuart, just on that point, I mean, obviously one of the key things it said was about how do we ensure it's sustained across all 32 community planning areas. I don't know what your experience is of that, as you know, hearing from the local areas,
and yes.
How do we get a more equitable, I suppose, experience?
I think you've used a good word there in terms of equitable. I think it will vary from area to area. I think a lot of that is based on the relationships that are built up over time. And how good or maybe not so good and challenging those relationships are. And one of the things that we can do is try and work to get those relationships as good as possible. I think COVID and currently the cost of living crisis have shown a real spotlight in a positive sense on the excellent work that the third sector does. And so I think the value of the third sector has become a lot more visible to many people through the response that they had there. And in fact, a lot of the resilience and adaptability that community planning partnerships have had through those two crises in particular has been due to the third sector. The difficulty then is how then that translates, as my colleague said there, into sustainability. You know, I think there's, from the third sector view, it's about trying to be recognised for what they provide and then resourced in an adequate way. And sometimes that's difficult, and there's a danger of mixed policy messages in terms of you've done a great job, you're really important, but there's a lack of resource, so you're going to get less money, and it's sometimes sort of making sense of that. You can understand that's frustrating for a lot of third sector organisations there. So I think it's building on the positive strides that's happened out of necessity over the last few years, and then trying to make sure that as far as possible we can you know, as many agencies can act to build those good relations across across the sector. But I think, you know, recognising what the third sector does and where they fit in and what the outcomes are is key to that. And that actually goes back to the last question as well about influence, because sometimes the influence people feel as an individual is due to being a member of a third sector organisation, and how then that third sector organisation acts as part of the community planning family. So that's kind of tied up together there.
Thanks, panel. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. I like that you called the community planning family, I think, seeing it all together, all these different elements, yes. I'm going to pick up on the theme of local outcome improvement plans and locality plans. And, Carol, I'm going to direct this question to you. Do you think that local outcome improvement plans and locality plans are the right mechanisms for tackling huge issues such as inequalities, poverty and climate change? Do they give an opportunity for taking a preventative approach?
As an auditor, I don't care what your mechanism is. I'm not sure that I can say whether or not I think it's an appropriate mechanism. It's not really for us to say at that. But what I would say is that what we would look for that will take a preventative approach is disrespecting boundaries, whether that's other partners or the third sector. It's working with communities. It's allowing them to influence decision making. It's about building trust and relationships, and focusing on those areas where most impact can be made, and prioritising those areas and involving people in those in the decisions about the services that they want. And I think it really is about breaking down boundaries between the other partners, so that the resources in a community can be used to best effect. And I'm repeating myself now from an earlier answer, but I can't say to you whether or not the LOIPs or the area plans are helpful in that way. They're a means to an end. It's the motivation, it's the ambition, and it's the willingness of all the people in the community planning family to work together to deliver on clear outcomes for particular communities.
So something about, you said both respecting boundaries but also breaking them down. So, but it's also something about, from what you're saying, something about making sure the right groups are involved in that planning process.
I said disrespecting boundaries.
Oh, disrespecting. Yeah. Okay, good. So, I'm glad you clarified that.
To work, ignoring the silos and, the name tags, who's what agency, but actually working collaboratively at that level. And I know that that does happen. I'm sure Stuart's got lots of examples about how that happens in local initiatives and projects across Scotland. But I think that's where the gains can be, is there's more disrespecting of boundaries at local level, and there's more joint working, more joint governance, more joint resourcing, more joint data sharing and scrutiny. And that's the way that we can make the most, I think, of community planning.
And I think that's some of what Tim said earlier on about during COVID, local authorities were much more flexible, and we're concerned that that's changing. So there's something about this respectful disrespecting of boundaries that needs to somehow stay in place. Did anyone else want to come in, Tim?
Yeah, you asked about LOIPs and whether they're effective. I think a good LOIP is effective if it's got a clear set of outcomes and a good data set to allow you to measure the outcomes, and unfortunately that doesn't always happen. And whether they're a good mechanism, in preparation for this meeting we produced a little table of all the best value reports we've done and which councils had LOIPs and which didn't, and a lot of them haven't in fact got them, so that's maybe an indicator. I don't want to draw too much from the data with an auditor beside me, but that's maybe an indicator that they're not working as envisaged. But a good one does work when it's got good data and good outcomes to measure. Or sorry, when I say good outcomes, I mean the outcomes can be measured.
Yes, absolutely. Measurable. They're smart.
Yep.
Well, that kind of connected to that, then I'd be interested to hear if you think that there's a cluttered landscape of plans. And maybe that's why some councils don't have them, because they've got to do so many other plans. So plans, responsibilities, strategic aims at local level. How do CPPs and individual partners connect their CPP duties to other areas of responsibility that IJBs, local planning, children's service planning, for example?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that the Scottish Parliament has kind of wrestled with and the Scottish Government has wrestled with for a number of years, how to declutter that landscape. And I think we had single outcome agreements at one point, and if I remember correctly, the thrust of that was to have one plan where everything was come in. Maybe that was a wee bit too ambitious to contain everything within the within one document. But I think what we need to look at is where and when we are introducing a new plan or a new set of plans, that we take account of the impact on other things, and particularly the local outcome, the LOIPs. So that we have somewhere that's got an overview of how these different plans are working together. Because what community planning is supposed to do is make sure that we work stronger together and that we're not pulling apart. And as the more separate plans we have, the greater sometimes the risk is that we do unintentionally pull apart. So it's those unintentional consequences as well. But if you have a strong LOIP and a strong community planning partnership, then you have a vehicle that can hopefully rein that in and say, oh, hang on a minute, this is what we're doing through children's services planning, but how does that impact on what we're doing with climate change, for example, or community safety? So you have to have a mechanism for those various different plans speaking together. I think where it can become sometimes messy is where you have local plans, but you also maybe have plans that are at a regional level, so mm-hmm. some of our economic plans, for example, then obviously the Scottish Government's got its national performance targets, and we have spoken in the past about a golden thread between that, and I think mm-hmm. it's about trying to get a sense of where each organisation fits in. As Carol said, disrespecting boundaries is a good thing, and maybe we should be challenging each other in a way, but in a positive way, to try and move those outcomes on. And I think it's about getting those dialogues right between those different things. So the different plans that we're developing, there may be a very good reason why there's a set of maybe three or four different plans, but as long as they are sort of speaking to each other and recognising what the impact is on each other, I think that's where we need to be.
Thanks. So something about coherence across all these plans. And of course, everyone's being asked to create plans while delivery is still needing to happen. So it's that kind of parallel process that's also challenging. Carol, you wanted to come in.
Well, you just stole my word, because that's what I was going to say. That's what we look for when we're auditing an individual council, is coherency in the plans. And plans are important. Without a plan, things won't happen. Yeah. Plans make things happen. But plans can be so complicated and so messy and so interlinked that actually they can stop things happening too. Or they can be perverse contradictions within plans. So what we look for is simplicity and coherence in the council's objective setting, its priority setting, how that links to the partner's priority setting, how they are demonstrating against the delivery against their key outcomes, because there's lots to measure. I'm sure Stuart will tell you how swamped in data there is, but is it data that tells us a story about whether things are improving? Not necessarily. There is a lot of data, and trying to see the wood through the trees is really difficult. And I think it's the clarity of the measures, as Tim said, being able to demonstrate those high-level priorities that they've been delivered against, and coherency in the plans so that they all align with each other rather than cut across each other mm-hmm. and become so complicated, so many measures and so many activities, that it becomes impossible to see your way through it.
Thanks for that. I think it's quite a skill set to be able to pull that all together as well, isn't it?
One of the good examples we've got at the moment, if I can just say, is the work that's happening across Scotland with The Promise, which is particularly for care experienced young people in care leavers, and the way that's kind of been nested into children's services plans, but also taking account of all the other partners who wouldn't immediately think of themselves as being providers of children's services. And it's about saying what more can be done. So that's, if you like, a universal aim to improve the outcomes for children, but within that, trying to reduce the inequalities for the care experienced young people's group, and the way that those are linking together, and the enthusiasm with which people are buying into that, I think is a good example, which will hopefully bear fruit.
Thanks very much for that. It's great to have that example of the promise. I'm going to move on to the next theme, and actually it's something we've been touching on but not delving into necessarily, and that's data, and that's questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. The issue of data has been touched on already, but back in 2013, Audit Scotland concluded that community planning partnerships are not able to show that they have had significant impact in delivering improved outcomes across Scotland. I was just going to ask Carol, would you make that same assessment now?
We haven't done any national work on community planning for a while, but we have done work on BVARs, Best Value Audit Reports, and individual councils. And we are still reporting similar messages about the ability to demonstrate those improved outcomes at a high level. That's still an issue. So there's still a bit of a disconnect between what's happening on the ground and how partnerships can demonstrate how all of that activity has contributed to delivering against priority outcomes. It's not easy. And as I said, we've discussed about the complexity of the planning arrangements, all the data and measures that go in there, that it is hard to extract from that and crystallise out those measures. But it's really important because that's demonstrating the worth. That's demonstrating what the planning partnerships can do.
Thank you for that, Carol. My next question, what evidence is there that community planning efforts are being focused on the most disadvantaged communities? And is there evidence of CPPs and individual partners using the data collected by the Improvement Service to target interventions and policies? And I'm going to pop that to Stuart.
Okay, thanks for that. Yeah, just to kind of rewind a wee bit to the data one, one of the issues that we sometimes find difficult in a local community planning partnership sense is getting data from lots of different sources. But when you go to present maybe an annual report through your LOIP, then a lot of the data won't have been maybe collected that year. So there's an issue with, so you don't really get that full picture. So there's an issue with the timing of data, how often it's collected, and then what is it you're actually trying to make a difference on. So you may be looking at something that's a longer term target. So if it's a behavioural change, for example, about public health, then it may be longer term rather than short term. So I think we sometimes need to have a think about what we expect to see from the data that we get back, and then do we have that, and then how do we supplement that data back? I think in the cases where we have strong data and we have a strong correlation between the data we have and the levers that the community planning partners have to pull and what that outcome looks like, I think we can see where there's a difference. But where there's a weaker link between that, so for example, a lot of the economic things will have maybe targets about jobs being created or the number of VAT-registered firms in a local area. But if you get something like the financial crash in 2008, then that's going to knock all them off. So I think it's about having an understanding of what the influence is of the community planning partnerships investment against what outcome you're looking to see. Sorry, I probably haven't explained that very well, but if there's anything you want me to clarify.
No, you're absolutely fine. Anybody else kind of want to come in on that?
Can I just echo the point Stuart made about the data? Because I know from my own practical experience when I was a councillor, getting data from, say, typically NHS, Police Scotland and the council, getting them to be coterminous, in other words, looking at the same period at the same time, is really difficult. I don't know if there's a role for Scottish Government in trying to get those data sets a bit more aligned, but it can be very difficult getting a set of data that's all looking at the same period.
In terms of the point you were raising about the inequalities, within areas, and you know, if the data's pointed towards that. I mean, I think the index of multiple deprivation has been good in terms of giving us a starting point from that. And as you say, the Improvement Service have got their own set of data about community planning, about the local areas. And we always have to look at that and then see what's changed since that data has come in. So, for example, sometimes if an area is coming out within the 5% most deprived in an SIMD iteration, then that might change if there's a housing demolition and renewal in that area. And that might not necessarily mean that the outcome is improved for the people who lived within that area. It might be a new cohort of people. So we always just have to factor in as much knowledge as we can about all these data sources to try and get as close to what we think is the true picture going on. So one of the things is, you know, and it's about the same with the other issues, is to try and get coherence between all the different bits of data that we all separately own to get something that's a bit better collectively.
I've certainly got to say I was really impressed by the level of detail that, you know, the Improvement Service held on the interface. It was quite impressive. My last question is, what are the biggest challenges and barriers to CPPs making the impacts the 2003 and the 2015 Act anticipated? I'll pop that back to Stuart, if you're okay with that.
Okay, sure. I mean, I think the biggest barrier for me is that it's always a moving target. As I say, it's nothing static. So the aspirations or the outcomes we were looking for at that particular time, 2008 financial crisis was probably before that, but obviously we've had the COVID and cost of living crisis, factoring in wars, energy crisis, all these sorts of things as well. So these are contextual things that we always have to take account of. I think some of the barriers we face, there's always going to be a resource barrier, but that's never going to change. We're always going to have more work to do than we have resource to be able to do it. And I think what we do have through community planning is a way to have that conversation about what do we need to focus on now and where can we upstream things. I think that is a huge barrier to community planning partnerships, is the aspirations to be able to, take early intervention. I think it's something that we'd always love to do more of, but the resources probably are very significantly squeezed in terms of that. And that's just in terms of we need to take those decisions to do that. That's a set of decisions that always needs to be taken and always needs to be reviewed and recalibrated as we go along to see what's best to do today. I think we've made really good strides. I think the Scottish Government has been good at being a partner in community planning at a local level, rather than the person that marks your jotters, if you like, marks your homework and tells you whether you're doing well or badly. I think that's been really positive as well. But I think that link between the local, the national and the regional, local, regional, national, can be much stronger as well. So those are some of the things.
Thanks for that. Carol, would you want to come in on anything?
I think it's a really difficult question to answer around the barriers. And I might just turn it on its head and say, well, what actually facilitates good partnership working? And I guess it's the things that I've mentioned before about building relationships and trust. And I really do think, and I've said it three times now, but disrespecting boundaries, that's, I think, is really hard to do. We all work in our silos and we all work under our own logos, and it's quite hard to kind of break that down. But it does happen at a very local level across councils across the country. But I think there is more to do about that. And I suppose the natural tendency in an environment like this, where there's so much uncertainty, so much financial pressure, is that agencies hunker down and do their core work. And I don't have any evidence to support that, but that's kind of my speculation on that. And what definitely doesn't help is not knowing what funding is going to be in future. So we're always ringing the bell for more fiscal framework that has more flexibility in that. And I think that is a barrier too. But as Tim has said and Stuart, there's a thing about coterminous as well. And there's very different culture between, say, the NHS and councils and different ways of operating. Those things get in the way as well as the data issues that Stuart mentioned about, you know, the timing and when it covers and trying to match these things together. So there's some structural elements that are barriers. But I think flipping it on its head, what makes change happen is people. So if you've got the right leaders with the right engagement, motivation, bringing people along, seeing that the levers that exist in other agencies out there with their own and using those levers to make change, I think that's when strategic change can happen.
Absolutely. Tim, do you want a last word on that last question?
No, my colleagues have
answered it
very well.
Thanks very much, Marie. We're now going to move on to culture change of statutory partners with Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. The witnesses will be aware of some of the conversations which are taking place with regards to local governance review and the potential development of a new deal. So thinking about those two things, just wondered where you think they have the opportunity to help improve the picture and take forward this empowering communities agenda. Carol, I'll maybe start with yourself.
I refer you to my last answer, really, because I think having that flexibility in the funding, flexibility to do things differently, more certainty about funding in the longer term, just creates more opportunities for councils to work with partners, communities, third sector to deliver on that. So I think the New Deal is an important part of that. And I think the Commission, and I won't speak on behalf of the Commission because Tim's sitting right next to me, but I'm sure the Commission are very keen for the New Deal to progress as soon as possible, because that will, at the moment, I think, is inhibiting things, but will, when it comes out, when it is agreed, will help councils to be innovative and to disrespect boundaries if that partnership agreement is framed in such a way that allows more flexibility.
Does anyone want to add any more?
Just to add to that. We have been pressing for a long time for what we refer to as a fiscal framework, which is a more long-term budgeting process for councils, so that they know more in advance what their likely funding streams are going to be. But also part of the New Deal is, as Carol has said, is I don't want to be controversial, but less ring fencing. Councils argue that ring fencing is constraining their ability to make a more localised choice. So what might well come out of the New Deal is less constraints in that respect for councils. And I think that will give them that freedom that they've been asking for, to disrespect boundaries to some extent, and that, I think, could well help.
Thank you for that. In terms of culture, and I probably want to bring together some of the questions which Annie Wells, Mark Griffin and Marie McNairn just asked as well. Where we are currently in being able to empower communities, my reading of it, and this is from the schemes I've been involved with in my own constituency area, is actually middle-class communities know how to use this and are well-organised to try to do that. So how do you think we can really take forward embedding further empowerment, especially for those who are furthest removed from decision-making and from the planning system, and being able to organise in a way which can genuinely make a sustainable project to take over community assets or to actually make the system work for them?
I think my experience and my thinking probably is slightly different, and it's kind of changed a wee bit. I think you're right in saying that some of the more affluent communities have got high levels of social capital and, you know, can organise themselves, have got skills and can do that. But that's sometimes equally the view on our most hard-pressed communities who have maybe been involved in going back to the 1990s and beyond in community engagement and schemes. And there's very often in those communities, I can think of some in our local authority area, where they are kind of highly organised and highly aware of how they can work with the system. I think there's then that bit in the middle, which are the bits that are neither tremendously affluent or very hard-pressed, where people are just kind of getting on with things. And I think those are the ones where there's sometimes fewer of an organised community culture that comes across and looks at the local assets. I think what we are finding in terms of culture change is that people are aware that if there is a bit of land or a building in their area, that they can actually go and ask about that. And it's not just the ones that, you know, a community planning partner doesn't want anything to do with. And certainly in our area, we've got some good and some quite diverse examples of land and assets being used. And I think the more that happens in an area, you start to build up a kind of critical mass of people within that community who know what the possibilities are, what outcomes can be achieved, but also have experience of how to do that. And then they start speaking to each other. And sometimes the best bits of community planning isn't what we try and do and try and control. It's about where the communities kind of learn from themselves. But it does take a while to get to that critical mass. And in terms of asset transfer, I don't think I've ever heard any community group say that was easier than I thought it was going to be. It's always the other way around. But if they've learned from that and are willing to share that, then that's when that critical mass starts to come. And we do have, you know, I have heard in areas of people in quite diverse communities starting to speak to each other about their different experiences and share their knowledge as well, which is invaluable.
Yeah, thanks for that. We need to get to that point, though, where people say that. So, yeah. Tim or Carol, do you have any points you want to raise on that?
I was just going to targeting. Mm-hmm. I think that you can't do everything for everybody all the time. So it has to be about prioritising where those areas or those communities are vulnerable and are in the more deprived areas. And as you say, those people might not be as engaged with the council, or actually there might be quite a groundswell of activism. But I think it's for the partnerships to target those areas and agree on where they want to focus. And that's the way to kind of engage those that are not engaging.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you.
Yeah. No, I would just add that it's not always, I think it's sometimes cultural rather than how well off people are, because you do get these hot spots of people who are quite engaged in the whole community planning, community empowerment process, and sometimes it is actually poorer communities that are doing it. But I think that's because, as Stuart alluded to, they build up a little pool of expertise, they see others doing it, and so that encourages it.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Miles. Just sticking on that theme, I've got a couple of other questions. So I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are on how community planning partnership works in practice among the statutory organisations. Has there been a genuine change in culture within partner organisations, for example, relating to budgets, staffing decisions and priorities? Any thoughts on that? Carol, anything?
I don't think I've got any evidence to be able to answer that question with any confidence, really. We've looked at individual councils and we've looked at their relationships with other agencies. And they do express that there are difficulties, particularly engaging with, say, the NHS. It's as I said earlier, it's organised in quite a different way. And councils having the democratic mandate, but NHS is direct relationship with government. So I don't think I can really give any more examples than that.
Thank you. Stuart?
I think just from my own experience, there's some good examples, but it's not organisations sharing their organisational budget. It's maybe a bit further down the level of parts of organisations coming together to maybe put in a bit of resource. But maybe not as formal as having a pooled budget. So certainly there's been some really good community safety work where you know, council wardens and the police and the fire service have kind of come together and are doing joint tasking and coordinating. at a local level and working with housing officers and things like that. So I think that's an area where that day-to-day staff resource and the budgets that are being put to certain things is working really well. But there wouldn't be a formal, you know, we'll all put our budget in the one pot from that side of things. I think there probably is more sharing of generally what the financial outlook is between different partners, but again, that doesn't really translate into, right, we'll put all our money into the one pot and decide what comes out of that. And in terms of the prioritising, I think the good work is probably, you know, there's probably an understanding at strategic level, but there's some particularly good bits of working at a slightly more kind of operational managerial level to look at that. So I'm thinking of things like local employability partnerships and partners working together to get sort of positive destinations for school leavers, those sorts of things where partners are working really strongly together.
Great, thank you very much for those examples. I've got another question. In Schedule 1 of the Act, it sets out a list of statutory partners, and I'd be interested to hear if you think it should be amended either to include new partners or perhaps remove existing ones.
So in terms of the statutory partners that we've got, I think they're generally fine. In terms of that, I think everybody most people that are there need to be there. I think it's worthwhile looking at the third sector interfaces. I don't think they can be statutory partners because they're not statutory bodies, but encouraging them to be as involved as possible might be a way to go forward. I think there's a difficulty with more regional-based partners about where they can play into, you know, so like Sofia, kind of Scottish, you know, enterprise groups, economic development groups, things like that, transport partnerships. It's quite difficult to play into the number of different community planning partnerships that they have to do. So maybe that's something that needs to be looked at to kind of make that process work more effectively for them.
Great. Thanks. Tim?
Yeah, I don't think I would take anyone out of the list. I don't know if there was anyone you were thinking of removing or adding.
No, not at all. Just wanted to ask the question.
Right. No, I suppose is the answer then. But I think Stuart makes a good point. There's all these other organisations which are maybe non-statutory or like, you know, Federation of Small Businesses, this kind of thing. It's useful to have them at the table. And I do know that some councils do engage with them, which is a good thing.
Thanks, that's helpful.
I think that is probably an area that could be strengthened as engagement with the private sector. The private sector is, you know, supposed to be one of the key arms of community planning. We tend to engage with chambers of commerce, and that's really good and that's really effective. But you know, maybe there's more that we can do. And we work through local employability partnerships and things like that, but maybe there's more that we can do with the private sector.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to our final theme, which is leadership and the role for the Scottish Government Audit Scotland, with Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, panel. I remember in 2003, when I was in East Ayrshire Council, one of the first of these community planning documents arrived, and I thought, goodness gracious, who's going to deliver this? It was words to that effect, I suppose, but who is going to be behind this and who's going to lead this? And the question of leadership arose very early and is still there. In my view, the success or otherwise of these things is very often down to good, strong, dynamic, enthusiastic leadership. It was just to ask for your views on that topic and how we can better provide that. I don't mean to ask you, is leadership important? We know it is, but how do we get the type and the quality of leadership to drive these plans, to engage with the communities who look to perhaps local authority officials to lead these processes too. So do you think we need to put more of a focus on it at national level? Should the Scottish Government make provision for skills and leadership? Should the local authorities do it? So just your views on that would be very much appreciated. I'll start with Stuart, if that's OK.
OK, thanks, Willie. Yeah, as you correctly identify, leadership is one of the things that drives the outcomes and gets you there. I think in terms of community planning, there was a bit of work done in Renfrewshire a while ago, and it was actually led by the police and fire in terms of having a leadership. It was not a qualification, but a process to go through for different community planning partners to buy into. So that was a bit of leadership that the police and fire were actually doing themselves, which was great from our perspective as a council. I think in terms of what we can do, there's the leadership of the community planning process itself, but making sure that the process happens and that the vehicle is fit for purpose. But then I think there's a leadership of the particular agendas that we want to look at. And the interesting thing for me is that there's different community planning partners that are sometimes the best face to lead some of these works. We've spoken a lot about community empowerment today, and sometimes the TSI, Third Sector Interface, will be the best person to lead that, because those are the people that the communities engage with most often. There's some work that's absolutely best led by councils, and others that are best led by, as I say, police and fire. And sometimes the fire are a really good organisation to lead, because they have a particularly high public approval rating, if you like. I think some sort of, maybe not leadership, you know, qualification that everybody's got to go through, but some kind of understanding of each other's agenda and each other's contribution is really important as well. I think the more we do that, the better we can do. And one of the, I think recently, the fact that the police have been adopting a public health approach to some aspects of their work is a really good example of that. I don't think that's been driven particularly through community planning, but that's effectively what it is. It's about one organisation saying, actually, there's a different way we should be looking at our business and taking that on board. And that, for me, is leadership. That's been led in that way to change the culture of how that organisation deals with certain things.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Stuart. Tim?
Yes, I mean, you're absolutely right about leadership being crucial. And, I mean, we referred to barriers to community planning partnerships working effectively. Sometimes it's poor leadership. And certainly in the best value reports, where we've identified that community planning partners are getting on well together, typically it's in a council with good leadership. Obviously, the other partners can have good leadership as well. But how to encourage it, it's difficult. Again, going back to our best value reports, we do always emphasise how important leadership is, and we always identify where we feel leadership has failed and caused a problem. And I hope that that encourages good leadership. But it's very sometimes quite difficult to define. We do actually sometimes define what we think of as good leadership. But forgive me, I can't quote you what that definition is. But it's like an elephant. You sort of know it when you see it, but how you get it is a difficult question. It really is.
Thank you.
So Carol may have the answer to that difficult question.
Well, I had a bit more time to think about it because you came to me last. But I'm thinking about actually how leadership has changed over the years. I mean, a direct route into chief executive of a council was to be the director of finance, and then leadership has changed. It's not about just managing a council now. It's about collaborative leadership. And we picked up on some of the principles of collaborative leadership in our last local government overview report. And we'll be picking up on it again now in terms of reform and redesigning services, because it isn't about necessarily just managing a council. There are managers in the council who manage a council. And Tim reminded me that there is a Scottish Leaders Forum, and I was at their last meeting, and somebody whose name I can't remember gave this quote, which I thought, oh, that's brilliant, I'm going to use that. And he said, leadership works when you leave at the door your silos, your logos and your egos. And I thought, I'll remember that because it rhymes, and it was very clever. I thought, But he was absolutely right. And I think it is about, as I said earlier, it's not, plans don't make change, people make change. Plans help us to get there, but it's actually the people that drive it forward. And I think in terms of the skill set now for a collaborative leadership, we're looking for people who are energised about making change. They might be voting for their own job to go, in a way. They'd be the people that have got a longer term vision about where they want to get to, and they will disrespect boundaries, number four. Time I said it, but they will be the ones that have the energy and are looking to the opportunities. Where are the levers? And if I don't have them, which other agencies have them and I can use them? How do we come together to make things happen? And I was impressed at that last meeting of the Scottish Leadership Forum that there was a lot of discussion about that, and people recognise it and understand it, and they know where they need to get to. I guess the next thing is, as an auditor, I want to see that it's happening. But there is a lot of talk about how collaborative leadership is what is needed to drive forward, and the change, the style of leadership, I think, has changed dramatically over the last 10, 20 years.
Responses, thank you so much for them. I just wanted to widen it a little bit, if I may, particularly to yourself, Carol. I mean, community planning isn't just something that the councils do. It stretches far further and wider of that. And I was just wondering if yourselves and Audit Scotland had any kind of element of that when you do your other work. For example, when you're looking at NHS services or you're looking at a whole range of other publicly delivered services, do you include, or might you include, community planning dimensions to that work a little bit more?
We definitely look at partnership working across the piece in the work that we do in the different... So my focus is around local government, but we have a team that look at the NHS every year. We've got a team looking at social care. But the more that we're working, the more integrated that work becomes, because the issues are not based in the silos. You know, the issues are cross-cutting. So I maybe wouldn't use the term community planning partnership, because that's a specific thing, but I think we'd talk about partnership working in its wider sense, and we would definitely talk about partnership working as to be including not just the public sector, but the third sector and communities. We speak about it in its widest sense. So yes, I think you'll see that's weaved through quite a lot of our work. Whether we're doing something specific on CPPs, I'm not sure if that was part of your question, but not at the moment. But we will continue to do work on best value in councils, which covers, obviously, partnership working. So that we will always be looking at partnership working in that respect.
Hi, thank you. My last question was just about whether you're intending, or the Accounts Commission intending, to audit CPPs as a process at all, or is that something that you're planning to?
It's not in our work programme at Pleasant.
No, we have done in the past.
Yeah, as Carol referred to, we did a report, how many years ago? A few years ago. So, you know, our work programme is always taking the sort of world circumstances into account. So you asking that question will certainly prompt me to ask that question when we're looking at our work programme, but there's nothing planned at the moment.
Okay. Thanks very much for that.
Thanks, Willie. Just Willie talked about skills in terms of leadership, and Carol, you were talking about collaborative leadership, and I just, something that comes up for me whenever you're bringing different organisations together is that skill of facilitation and that breaking down of the silos, and I just wondered if you thought that the leaders... You know, a collaborative leadership style would have that skill of facilitation, of bringing people together, or do we think we also need people who are specifically trained as facilitators that could come in, you know, into certain situations to kind of do that work of helping the silos to break down?
I think either or both, to be honest. And I think it's not just about the corporate leadership and the corporate collaborative leadership. I think that there's also the political leadership as well. So what might be a barrier, and I'm speculating, to be clear, I don't have any audit evidence about this, but what might be a barrier is the energy and drive across some of the chief executives to move things forward in quite a different way might not be reflected in terms of, I'm thinking about joint services and so on. If the political persuasion of the councils that want to work together is different. That could maybe get in the way of things. So I think maybe facilitation around that, getting over those barriers, might be an issue. But as I say, I'm thinking on my feet and speculating really about that. But I think both people who have that skill set and have been trained to have that skill set, or external support that might come in, depending on what the circumstances are.
Yeah, thanks for that. It just seems to me that more and more evidence sessions I sit through, both in this committee and another committee I sit on, I feel like Scotland needs facilitators, really well-trained ones. Stuart, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, so it was just to say, and it probably speaks to Willie's last point about leadership as well, is the work of the Community Plan Improvement Board. So that's very much about sort of looking about how we kind of drive forward the community planning system as a whole, and how those the leaders of the different national community planning partners kind of take ownership of that within their own organisations, but in a collective and collaborative sense. And that is facilitated by the Scottish Government, the Improvement Service, and you know, one of my colleagues from the Community Planning Networks that feeds into that as well. So it's a good example of, you know, trying to look at the system as a whole and move that on and move that together.
Thank you very much for that. So that concludes our run through the themes, and I think it's been a very helpful next level of our work on community planning partnerships. So thanks so much for coming in today and sharing your perspectives and your experience. And I now suspend the meeting to allow a change of witnesses. Thank you.
Our second panel of witnesses, we're joined in the room by Peter Kelly, who's the director at Poverty Alliance, Kirsty McNeil, who's the Policy and Research Officer at Coalition for Racial Equality and Rights, CRER, and Ruth Watling, who's the Head of Policy and Equality at Homeless Network Scotland. And we're joined online by David Allen, who's the Deputy Director at Scottish Community Development at the Scottish Community Development Centre. And I welcome the witnesses to the meeting. As mentioned in the first panel, we'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible. But if you would like to come in, please indicate to the clerks. And David, as you're appearing virtually, please do this by putting an R in the chat function. And we're going to begin our questions with Annie Wells, who, and I'll just, we'll actually say we've got three colleagues who are joining us virtually. So we'll be some questions coming from people online. Annie.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. What do you think are the main challenges faced by communities across Scotland, and have these changed in the years since the Act was passed in 2015? For example, we talk about the COVID pandemic, but also looking ahead, what role could CPPs have in supporting communities during the cost of living crisis? And I think I'll put that one to David first, if you don't mind.
Hey, hi, yeah, thanks, Annie. I think the main challenge is obviously during COVID was, well, faced everybody during the pandemic, increasing isolation of our disadvantaged and more fragile communities. They're coming out of COVID, going straight into a cost of living crisis, exacerbated the problems facing our communities. Biggest problems and the biggest. So that's what's happened through the.
David, sorry to interrupt, but your audio is dropping out a bit. So I think we'll just check with broadcasting. Should we drop the video and just see if it works with audio or. Yeah? Okay. Thanks. Okay, if you want to.
Sorry about that. Is that.
Brilliant. Go ahead.
Is that better? I was just saying, moving from the pandemic and the increasing of some groups of them into being faced with the cost of living crisis.
Okay, so your audio is still bad. We're still not hearing you fully. So maybe we can go to someone in the room and we'll try to work on the tech side of things. Peter Kelly, do you want to come in?
Yes, happy to. Thank you for the question. Thanks for the invitation to come along this morning. I think the main challenges facing communities, so the Poverty Alliance is obviously coming from a perspective of our key concern is around poverty and inequality. And I think the challenges faced by communities and therefore by community planning partnerships over the last 7 or 8 years since the passing of the Act, and indeed before that, is the rising pattern of poverty and inequality in Scotland, and indeed across the UK. And I think the significant challenge there is that's very oftentimes out with the control of community planning partnerships to really have a significant impact on some of those patterns. So we've seen over the period, even since 2015, we've seen downward pressure on the incomes of those who are already on the lowest incomes through a whole series of changes and cuts to social security. So that context, I think, has made some of the long-term changes that community planning partnerships want to make all the more difficult to achieve. I think also going into the pandemic, that clearly exacerbated many of the problems that were already existing in many communities. And I know that the committee and parliamentarians will have heard a great deal over the last several years about exactly what those problems were. And I think Dave was starting to talk about that isolation that took place. Members of the Poverty Alliance talked about the so-called supercharging of existing inequalities during the pandemic. So these have all made some of the challenges that the structures that are in place to address poverty and inequality all the more difficult.
Thanks. Ruth?
Thank you for inviting me as well. It's great to have a homelessness organisation as part of this discussion, so thank you. And just building on what Peter was saying about poverty, it's the most important driver for homelessness, and that there's a big risk, therefore, that homelessness is going to increase, and that prevention of homelessness can be tackled really effectively at a local level, and the community planning partnerships have a really key role to play there. I just wanted to say a little bit about the pandemic and the impacts on homelessness, which you'll have probably all seen. There was quite a positive impact for parts of homelessness, for rough sleeping. The numbers dropped significantly. They have gone back up a little, but they're quite low in Scotland. The main homelessness issue in Scotland is seen as kind of an indoor problem more than an outdoor problem. And the positives that came from the pandemic in terms of people not being evicted because of legislation that was introduced by Scottish Government are at risk of kind of creating, not, no, that's the wrong way of saying it. There's a risk that the impact of the cost of living crisis and the other issues that Peter was alluding to are going to increase the numbers of people that are homeless. There's already increases in the number of open homelessness applications and the numbers of people in temporary accommodation. So, yeah, a massive opportunity for the community planning partnerships to play a role in how we prevent that.
Thanks. Kirsty.
Yeah, thank you for inviting us along today to contribute. So one of the main challenges that we think there is for Black and minority ethnic communities in Scotland, which is linked to both COVID and the current cost of living crisis, is poverty. So stats say that somebody from a Black and minority ethnic background is more than twice as likely to be in poverty as somebody from a white Scottish or British background in Scotland. And what we see is that despite requirements for the Community Empowerment Act for socioeconomic inequalities to be taken into account, there's a kind of race-blind approach to tackling these inequalities. And on poverty, we know that the local child poverty action reports are created each year, and they're presented to the Scottish Government by health boards and local authorities, but in practice, community planning partnerships would be a useful vehicle to deliver these reports, basically. And our research has shown that basically the local child poverty action reports are also taking a race-blind approach to their work, as far as we can see from the written reports. So the reports don't discuss in detail how child poverty is affecting different Black and minority ethnic children or groups in the area. There's no targeted action. And also there's very little data on whether Black and minority ethnic families are engaging with mainstream services that are there. Just basically that Black and minority ethnic people are at higher risk of poverty, but you can't really see that through the community planning partnerships work necessarily from our experience.
Thanks, Kirsty. And we're going to go back and try David now. We made some adjustments. Let's see if we can hear you.
Hopefully. Can everybody hear me now okay?
So far, so good.
Okay. I think what I was saying before, I'm picking up on a couple of the other... Well, I think things have changed over that time. I think the pandemic brought to the fore issues of, you know, people being isolated, increasingly isolated in style. And where issues maybe around about poverty tend to have been more concentrated in urban areas, the urban areas of deprivation, I think they've become far more widespread. Rural deprivation and a huge, huge issue as well. And I think playing into community planning agenda, that kind of dispersed nature of poverty or fragility becomes more difficult, I think, for community planning partnerships to deal with. We've got the issue of critical mass, you know, where you maybe have only two or three people in a particular area with a particular issue or a particular group, then it becomes more difficult for kind of place-based response, if you like, that's more to those are real challenges moving.
Thanks very much for that, David. I'd just like to move on a wee bit. I mean, we heard from the last panel about the lack of data, but we do have some data, and there is data collected by Improvement Services show massive inequalities between communities which are in the same local authority area. And for example, in Glasgow, between Springburn and Maryhill and Kelvinside and Jordan Hill. So reducing inequalities is a core purpose of the community planning, but how successful do you think that's been? I don't know who wants to kick that one off. Maybe David, seeing as you're still on my screen at the moment.
Okay, yeah, I think the thing about data is really interesting, and interesting the conversation earlier on in the first part of the session. I think not just about the synchronising of data between agencies, but also about what data communities bring. Well, we were involved a couple of years ago working with a couple of local groups in Moray in developing community-led locality plans. And they were conscious of the fact that the kind of data they were bringing into perspective, how did that match up and actually add to and complement the data that was being gathered by the council and the statutory partners? And they actually made a good example of bringing in the council statisticians to work with the groups to look at the actual breakdown of the data in the areas, because they had localities placed on them which didn't make any sense to the communities involved, but they were based on the raw data in terms of level of deprivation 70s. Whereas the natural communities didn't conform to those boundaries. So they actually worked well with the community planning partners to, you know, redefine those boundaries. So they made more sense, but also recognising where there were concentrations of issues or problems or inequalities, if you like, as well. They see a way of bringing that together by addressing that as a whole community and not focusing on one particular small part of the area.
Thanks for that, David. Just to say, your audio is still dropping out. I think Kath's going to chat to you through the BlueJeans function, and we'll see if we can sort that out still. Anyone in the room want to comment? Peter?
Yeah, just to quickly follow up on what Dave was saying, I think the question around data and whether we're having an impact on inequalities, they're related but almost separate questions. So I think there's, over the period that I've observed community planning, I've seen a better use of data, and I've seen data being used more creatively. I've seen the various different actors at local level very focused on how they use data and trying to understand the data that's available to them. So, for instance, in Inverclyde, I know there's been a great deal of work going on there with the local authority and with Public Health Scotland supporting and with the Improvement Service supporting to better understand the data that's available and how that can be applied. This is in the context of local child poverty action reports, but I think the example is applicable to wider community planning. So I think there's more and better data around, and I think what Dave was saying about other forms of data, and particularly qualitative data, being brought in, I think is really important. The question, though, about are the long-term outcomes that are set in LOIPS and elsewhere in other versions of plans, are inequalities reducing? Again, I think we need to tease out what is within the gift of the various local community planning partners to affect those long-term outcomes. They may well set them, but what's within their gift to actually achieve them? So we know that, for instance, health inequalities very worryingly are starting to widen again in Scotland. And I think that the community planning partners can make a significant contribution to reducing those inequalities. But there are patterns taking place. There are processes taking place at Scottish and UK level that are driving some of those widening inequalities. And I think we need to get that balance right between understanding the specific role of community planning partners in reducing those inequalities and the contribution that they make to that.
Okay, Annie, have you got any more questions?
Yeah, just one final question, convener. And this was something that Kirsty sort of spoke on a little bit earlier. As well as communities of place, the guidance of Part 2 of the Act spoke about the impacts on communities of interest. So what evidence is there that community planning partnerships are identifying and engaging with these communities? And I'll put that one to Kirsty first, please.
Yeah, thank you for the question. So in our work, anti-racism and race equality, there's actually a considerable body of evidence that geographical approaches to tackling these inequalities quite often fails and often can actually widen inequalities. In our experience of locality planning to a greater or lesser extent here actually really replicates that. There is little evidence to show that locality planning is working for Black and minority ethnic groups. And these communities are kind of largely absent from the structures that are responsible for locality planning. And if we discuss the plans in more detail later, we'll see that there is very little mention of them in there. One thing I will say is that not me, but previously staff within CRER had supported a senior colleague within one of the most prominent community planning partnership organisations to kind of put forward a communities of interest focused locality plan. And this colleague had been able to come up with proposals that would target severe inequalities, but staying firmly within the locality's eligibility criteria. But unfortunately, that didn't go ahead, which was really down to kind of more reluctance at senior level, where commitment to and also understanding of inequalities is low. And I think the community of interest in particular there was for the African community within Glasgow.
Thanks very much for that. I don't know if Ruth, if you get anything to add.
I think for homelessness, it's kind of people come in and out of homelessness, so it's not really the same. But people who are at risk of homelessness or at risk of kind of the more repeat or entrenched forms of homelessness are people that are really on the margins of society. They're kind of marginalised, discriminated against, kind of, you know, across the board, and are the least likely to be engaged with in kind of the planning processes. And so one of the things that our organisation would really welcome is something in the LOIPS about preventing homelessness, which would therefore require engagement at a more kind of organised, you know, systemic kind of level with people who are at higher risk of homelessness, many of which will be people that Kirsty's talking about and people that Peter's talking about. So it's not kind of the same, you know, clear group in a sense.
Peter, have you got anything you'd like to add?
No, I think colleagues have covered the points well.
Thanks very much. Thanks, convener.
Thanks, Annie. And we're now going to move on to our second theme, which is community empowerment. And Mark Griffin, who's joining us online, will ask those questions.
Thanks, convener. I've got a few questions about community empowerment. Community Empowerment Act was supposed to strengthen people's voices, you know, give them a say in the services that they rely on. And so I wanted to ask particularly about disadvantaged and marginalised communities as to whether that's actually been realised at all as a result of the Community Empowerment Act, and what more we should be asking government to do to actually to realise that, to give those marginalised and disadvantaged communities a voice in the services that they rely on. Perhaps come to Peter first, then Ruth.
Thank you. So I think in terms of community empowerment, community involvement, participation, whatever phrase you want to use for it, we are very much still on a journey. You know, the 2003 Act talked about making sure that people in communities are genuinely engaged in decisions that affect their lives. I think we could say that across Scotland, there are large parts of Scottish society, large parts of the population, where they would not feel as though they they are actively engaged in the decisions that affect their lives. And I think things have changed and things have improved, and particularly since the Act in 2015, things have definitely changed. But I think there's an awful lot of scope for further improvement. I guess what we also see, and again, I'm going to use the lens of the local child poverty action reports, which are obviously a requirement under the Child Poverty Act in 2017. But we've seen some really quite creative approaches to involving people with direct experience of poverty and trying to shape those approaches to addressing child poverty at local level. We've seen a whole range, and I can talk at length about the different examples where local authorities, community planning partnerships have actively sought ways to engage with people. But those examples of good practice, I would say, are still in the minority. I don't feel as though across community planning partnerships in their totality, I don't think we've embraced participation in the way that I guess we'd hoped we would have done through the Act. So I think there's been improvement, there's been progress. I think there's still much more that can be done.
Do you want to come in?
Yes, I was going to kind of add to what Peter was saying. I agree. I think there's a lot in national and local policy. There's a lot written about the fact that we need to engage with people more widely. It's not, the practice is not as consistent, certainly across Scotland it's not consistent. And I was reminded of a piece of work that Heriot Watt University did in England, actually, but I think it probably is, there's probably relevance here, which suggests that localism can actually serve to further marginalise particularly severe and multiply deprived people in the community. So I think similar to what you were saying earlier, Kirsty, unless we put enough time, efforts and expertise into meaningful engagement with people who are less likely to trust public services, who may have experienced trauma, who are kind of at that hard end of having experienced homelessness and all sorts of crises in their lives. Unless we actually get better at that, we're at risk of kind of further marginalising. So I guess things have improved. It's talked about a lot more than it used to be, but there's still, I think, a long way to go to have consistent practice.
Thanks. Kirsty.
Yeah, thank you, Ruth, for that. Some really good points there. So at a national level, we actually undertook a review of all the LOIPs to look at how they had detailed involvement with Black and minority ethnic groups. And we found that very few of them were carrying out involvement, or at least it wasn't detailed in these reports. A small number of them did have mechanisms for engagement with those with protected characteristics, or I think one or two for on race issues specifically, but that isn't widespread. And hopefully I'm not getting too detailed here, but we also looked at some of the locality plans within Glasgow. And on these as well, there was little evidence of the involvement of Black and minority ethnic groups. But I just wanted to highlight one example of good practice, which was in Govan Hill. Their locality plan actually notes the involvement of Black and minority ethnic groups through community conversations, which were actually facilitated by a multilingual team. And they also note the specific involvement of Black and minority ethnic groups. So I think there's maybe a need for individuals and groups responsible for leading on the development and delivering of these plans to specifically set out how equality groups are involved in the related processes. But there is little incentive really for marginalised communities to contribute their views or their time to involvement processes, which might not actually improve their circumstances.
Thanks. And I believe Dave wants to come in at this point too.
Yeah, it was just to kind of emphasise what the other panel members have already said, but I think we've seen the need for a systematic approach to supporting community involvement in community planning. I think Peter mentioned, it's still a bit sporadic. The good examples are out there, but they're still very dispersed and not across the board. And I think what the Act, you know, really required authorities to do and community planning partnerships to do was to take a systematic approach to involving communities and the whole range of communities that were in their area to be involved in community planning processes and improving things. And that's not been done. And I think there are numerous reasons for that. But I think that's where we need to get better at. We need to be more systematic and put sufficient time and resource into helping people to participate and on an equal basis with others who may be more, you know, comfortable with doing that. And again, the conversation about, you know, whether the Act has just helped stronger communities become even stronger and not, you know, actually helped to level the playing field in terms of community participation. I think we need to look at that.
Thanks very much, David. Mark, do you have more questions?
Yeah. You know, community empowerment comes from strong relationships between members of staff and public services and the community itself. That's from an impact report of the Castaic Commission. It's obvious, it goes without saying. But if I can come to Kirsty first and just ask, you know, since the 2015 Act was introduced, do you think there has been a change in how open public services are in terms of their staff, how they are going out, how they are engaging, how they are building relationships and trust with marginalised communities? And is the culture changing within staff and public services to the extent that we're actually getting meaningful engagement and participation?
Yeah, to answer your question, I think it's difficult for us to be able to speak for every area within Scotland because we obviously don't know the ins and outs, and all we can see is really from the plans from those areas that we're not involved in. Within Glasgow, I would say that work that is done through the community planning partnerships tends to be through good working relationships that are there. But there's sometimes kind of, you know, there's a barrier there with the people at a higher level that are maybe not as involved with equalities, because I think there is a kind of lack of resourcing sometimes relating to equalities, both within specific posts and also generally through public service organisations.
Thanks for that. Anyone else want to come in?
Mark, Peter is going to come in.
Yeah, just to quickly follow up again, in terms of that, the relationships between officials that are tasked with producing reports, whatever form. I think, again, we've got good evidence of change. So a few community planning partnership areas. So Edinburgh, I think, has done some really interesting work to engage with people with direct experience of poverty in a really ongoing, long-term basis so that flowing from the Edinburgh Poverty Commission that was set up, that's now really part and parcel of the LOIP. It's referred to in the LOIP, the End Poverty Edinburgh Group, which is a group of citizens in Edinburgh with experience of poverty. And I think what we've seen work there, and this would be the same in other community planning partnership areas, is the time taken to build relationships and the resources put in generally by the local authority, I would say, taking the lead in this very often, to make sure that those relationships are built up. So Edinburgh is a good example. I would say that Dundee similarly has an approach where participation and involvement is seen as a priority in the development of local child poverty action reports. Other areas, so rural communities, I think there are some examples of good practice there as well. In Aberdeenshire, for example, they adopted quite innovative ways of trying to engage with a panel of people with experience of poverty, which worked quite effectively during the pandemic as well, doing it remotely, online type engagement. So I think there's a lot of good examples, but I would repeat the point that I made earlier, that the whether they are embedded enough in the way that community and planning partnerships go about their business, I would have to say I'm not convinced.
Thanks for that.
Thanks, Peter. Final question, convener. Just a broad question, probably to all four members of the panel, just to ask, you know, are the groups that you're involved in, are they even aware of community planning partnerships? Do they know what they do? Do they know how to get involved?
Bruce, do you want to pick that up?
It will vary a lot. I think that there are pockets of, as we've been talking about before, that there's areas where we've maybe had programmes of work where people are maybe a lot more aware of what the local planning arrangements are. But things like LOIPs, people generally don't know how significant they are in local planning and what they drive. Absolutely, I think there is quite a big gap in awareness amongst the people that we work with.
And David.
I think I would agree with that. I think the experience from feedback from the groups that we work with and support across the country is that kind of where they're aware of community planning partnerships, it's a lack of understanding of how they can get involved and how they can influence those processes and structures as well. So there's kind of different levels there. They may be aware, the more active groups certainly may be aware of community planning, but less aware of how they can actually get involved and influence decision making.
Peter.
Yeah, echoing what Dave has just said, I think there's an awareness amongst community organisations and voluntary organisations in our network. I would say there's an awareness of community planning partnerships and what their function is, I think. But their capacity to engage, I think, is limited. And that's a strategic decision that many organisations will take. Their purpose is not to engage in community planning processes. Their purpose is to achieve the ends of their organisation. So it's about community planning partnerships finding the ways where that engagement can be made relevant and possible. And I think, you know, the TSIs do broadly a good job in representing third sector voices. There's a different question again when we're thinking about people with direct lived experience. But I think, by and large, I think TSIs are doing a good job in their engagement, often quite in difficult circumstances for the TSIs as well, to be part of community planning partnerships, and their role is really important.
Thanks. Kirsty, do you have anything to add?
No, I think the answer's been well covered.
Pretty much covered, okay. We're now going to move over to the role of the third sector with Paul McClellan.
Thanks, convener, and thanks, panel. Just really trying to touch on, I think the points have been raised a couple of times around about the involvement of the third sector. And I used to chair a community planning partnership when I was councillor there in East Lothian. One of the key things is you see the local organisations involved, but you don't see issues, for example, about your own organisations involved in that. And one prime example this morning was a poverty-related stigma report that came out from your own organisation, Peter. And it particularly mentioned, Kirsty, around about BME being particularly affected by the issues around about stigma, twice as more likely to be affected than that. How, in terms of the community planning partnerships, do we get national organisations involved in some of these discussions down at a local level? Because I think that's fundamental, because if we're talking about addressing some of these issues, they need to be addressed at a local level. And you touched upon what the work Inver Clyde was doing, for example, around about that. So that was probably the first question. The second one, and Peter, again, you mentioned that it was in the role of the TSIs. We took evidence, and some of the feedback we got from the third sector in terms of TSIs was very mixed. So there were some that were very good experiences, others not so. So how do we try and get that equitable experience across all local authorities? So, Peter, I'll probably come to yourself based on just on that first question, first of all, and then open it up, if that's OK.
It sounds like Thanks for the question. It sounds like a kind of glib answer, but it's about resources, it's about capacity. So for national organisations like our own, you know, we've seen that the community planning partnerships are an important locus for influencing change and for trying to influence change at a local level. But the reality of trying to engage with 32 community planning partnerships is just beyond our capacity. So there's a question there, I think, of finding efficient ways to take the learning from where there is good examples of good practice, working around some of the themes that my organisation and colleagues work on, and applying those to different places. And I think, again, there's good evidence where we're starting to be able to do that a lot better. So things like the improvement service, I think, in the, again, I'm speaking mostly about the child poverty area, have been very effective at sharing good practice with officers that are engaged in child poverty planning at local level. I think that's been really important. Organisations like SCDC, I think, are really important in sharing good practice around what works and involvement. And I think trying to find more and better ways to do that is really important. So support for national infrastructure organisations like our own is really important, that we can then share some of the lessons that we're learning. So again, the work that we've done around child poverty over the last, since the Act, since 2017, has gathered a lot of good experience of good practice in Edinburgh, Glasgow, Inverclyde, Dundee, Aberdeenshire. I think we possibly haven't had the opportunity to really share that in as systematic a way as we would like, but I'm sure other third sector national organisations would be in the same position. So resources are really important, but then I think recognising that constraint, finding ways to efficiently share what we're learning more effectively is really important.
I don't know if anybody else wants to come in on that one. Ruth?
Similar to Peter, I think we have done recently completed a programme of work called Staying In, which is about place-based approaches to preventing homelessness. And some of the recommendations from that are really for local planning partners. And we are going to their local planning meetings as much as we can. They're in Glasgow in particular, where some of the projects took place. So what we're looking at doing is recognising that we can't do that for all of the community planning partnerships, is looking at a national sharing of good practice as well, looking at getting champions. So where we have got local areas who are taking on board the recommendations, you know, really sharing that and saying, you know, look what you can do if you do this a little bit differently. So it's kind of looking for clever different ways to influence change. But I think this is pertinent to the point that you were making, the questions later about leadership as well. The local planning mechanisms, the people that sit within them, have to see these things as important to their work and seek that as well as us trying to influence that.
Yep. Anybody? I don't know if anybody else wants to come in.
David, you wanted to come in, and then Kirsty.
To reinforce what Peter and Ruth have both said, I think actually the importance of being able to share learning for the CPPs themselves and those involved can't be overstressed. We were involved with Improvement Service a couple of years ago and doing a programme or work with all 32 CPPs to look at what they were learning about community participation and community involvement and community planning. And that was an example of where that kind of sharing of learning was really, really useful for all the CPPs involved. And we had folk involved from the CPPs, not just from the statutory agencies, but also community reps, the TSIs, and so on, and elected members in that process. So I think the role of the kind of national intermediaries, if you like, and I agree with Peter, that needs to be resourced, can be really important in terms of helping to share that learning wider across about what works and also what gets in the way of good community planning as well.
Thanks. And Kirsty?
Yeah, to answer your question about the involvement of national level organisations in local planning, CRER are a national level organisation, but we also do work at a Glasgow level. So we were involved in a quality focused engagement around the plan in Glasgow. So I couldn't really comment on the kind of wider third sector involvement in Glasgow aside from the equalities. So as members of the equalities group, the CPP and equalities group, we had a direct input through that, as well as our own kind of written input to consultations. And we also did some facilitation with smaller community groups. However, as I detailed more in our written response to this, to the previous consultation, none of those routes provided a particularly successful outcome. So I think to say that regardless of how well that we are involved in these processes, the decisions are ultimately kind of made at the highest strategic level. And from this point of view, it wouldn't necessarily be a good use of our time to get involved with every single local area. And also there's probably small black and minority ethnic groups that are more better placed within their area to speak to the issues that might be quite fairly unique to their area.
Thanks, Paul. So I'm going to move on to local outcome improvement plans and locality plans, which is my theme. And in the interest of time, I'm going to try to combine three questions into one. And also, I think a number of you have already touched on the what I've now learned are called LOIPs, local outcome improvement plans. And thank you, Kirsty, to your organisation for doing that bit of work on looking at how LOIPs you know, whether they actually engage with BAME people. But so I'd be interested to hear from others around the, you know, do we think that they address the inequalities that communities face? Do they take a preventative approach where they exist? And then also, do you have a sense that there's maybe a cluttered landscape that these plans need to fit within? Or how do CPPs and individual partners connect their CPP duties with other areas of responsibility like IJBs, local planning, locality planning and children's services? So a bit on there, are they actually effective? Do they take the preventative approach? And are they in a cluttered landscape? Who wants to give that a go? David?
Yeah, to address the cluttered landscape thing, first, I think, yes, there is a cluttered landscape in terms of local planning processes, and I think that's becoming even more cluttered with the development of like local place plans under the Planning Scotland Act last year. These are all really good opportunities for people to be involved in influencing local planning, but I think there's a danger that people just don't know where that will land. And, you know, is there a kind of, you know, which plans take precedence, if you like, and there's not really anywhere that we can see at the moment is really addressing that. And I think that needs to be addressed for people to genuinely feel they're being involved and engaged in influencing the development of services and responses at local level. Generally, so I mean, I think where local folk are getting involved in locality planning in particular, I think we've seen some good examples of that, and that's been where it's been more of a community lead in those processes rather than being a top-down process. But I think there's got ways to go on that yet, and particularly in terms of how more marginalised communities can contribute to that kind of planning process.
Thanks for that. Anyone else? Any bits of what I asked? Kirsty?
Yeah, I'll just, in the interest of time, kind of summarise a little bit from our written response. So we undertook a review of the Local Outcome Improvement Plan, or LOIPS, and it showed that the majority have very little equality focus in terms of race, despite guidance that plans should demonstrate understanding of local needs and circumstances. And while a few were able to highlight kind of specific actions for black and minority ethnic communities, the majority did not address these inequalities, and even where inequalities were kind of mentioned. There really wasn't a discussion of strategies to kind of tackle and address the inequalities. They're just stated without any action coming up after that. And to talk about the preventative approach, a kind of common theme we see on issues affecting Black and minority ethnic communities is that there's an acknowledgement of the problem, as I've just kind of said, for example, high poverty rates or disproportionate levels of hate crime, but this doesn't actually translate into preventative action. And one area that we think community planning could have a much stronger role in preventative approaches to reducing inequalities is on community cohesion. So there's a strong relationship between community cohesion, safety and discrimination. And we know that also there's a large number of racist hate crimes taking place in Scotland. And this kind of contributes to a lack of cohesion at a local level, which needs local solutions. So we think that a good way forward would be for community cohesion to be built into local outcome improvement work. This could create better relationships in local communities and ultimately help to prevent hate crime and improve people's lived experience, basically. And one way to help this to happen would be to have a look at amending the Community Empowerment Act to require CPPs to act with a view to promoting community cohesion. And I don't have an answer on the cluttered landscape. I think that's a better place for others to answer.
Thanks very much. Anybody else? Peter.
Yeah, maybe just starting on the cluttered landscape, I think, yeah, it probably is. And it feels cluttered from an organisation that's external to those processes that doesn't have a responsibility for actually complying with them. From discussions that we have with officials, it certainly feels burdensome from their point of view in the conversations we've had. And I think what then happens is that for external organisations, you gravitate towards those processes where there is an opportunity to try and influence things. And I don't know if the LOIPs are generally seen as that, partly because they're long-term processes that are reviewed regularly, but they're very long-term. But we've seen, certainly in the local child poverty action report process, opportunities to actually have an influence on what community planning partnerships do, and particularly what local authorities do, but what the partnerships do and how they actually use resources. So we've seen that both in the work that we've been involved in Renfrewshire, where resources have followed engagement, which has been really positive. That's the thing that you want to see, and similarly in Inverclyde as well. But there's no doubt that it's a cluttered landscape, and it's difficult, I think, for those of us who are external to say this is the place that's important, because this is where decisions will be made. In terms of do they address inequalities and are LOIPs taking a preventative approach, I think the ones that I've read certainly use the language and talk about it. But again, I'll go back to that earlier point about the context that we're working in, where the cost of living crisis or the pandemic has radically impacted on the ability of community planning partners to actually follow through on that preventative approach, when really, quite rightly, what they've been doing for the last 3 years really is responding to crises. So I think there's a question there about how we hold that preventative approach coming out, one hopes, coming out of the crisis that we're in at the moment, and getting back to ensuring that we are taking a properly preventative approach.
Thanks for that. And I think that's really a good point that you're making, that we are in this context of coming out of COVID and the cost of living, and we're in the cost of living crisis, and then that changes what needs to be addressed. More urgent things come to the fore in a way. I'm going to move on to the next theme, which is measuring impact and the use of data. And I think we've touched somewhat in the beginning on data, but Marie McNair, come on in. Marie is joining us online.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I think actually good afternoon, panel. Actually, I think the first questions we kind of covered, so I'm going to move on to the next, kind of our CPPs and our partners using data to inform targeted interventions and policies. And I'll put that to Peter first.
I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch the whole question there.
sorry, maybe want to turn my camera off, it's kind of struggling to hear myself. Are CPPs and their partners using data to inform targeted interventions and policies?
I think from the evidence that I see, I think there's a real acute awareness about the need to use high quality data. I think there is a challenge around some of the issues that we would be most concerned about in terms of poverty, about having good data at the local level that is timely. So that's always a challenge around income and poverty statistics. They are generally at best a year out of date when they arrive, and because of the pandemic, they've been even more out of date and less reliable. So I think that question of getting access to good data around these issues is really important. Then how you supplement that data if it's not available, that can be gathered, I think, as David was saying earlier, about thinking about how we use engagement to supplement where there may not be those really useful sources of data. And then there are other experiences. I mentioned Inverclyde previously. I think there's been really good work going on in Inverclyde to make better use of data and to ensure that data is really well aligned with the outcomes that are being set and the targets that are being set. So I think, again, some good evidence of the importance of using data. I think some work that we're involved with in Midlothian at the moment has come up as a key issue amongst community planning partners, that the need for better data is still there. So I think, again, it's a continual process where as new issues are identified, we need to identify data sources to support effective planning around them.
Ruth?
To talk a little bit about the homelessness data, which is national data. It's great data. It's Scottish Government collected, and it's collected from people who approach the local authority for support. Similar to Peter, but not such a time lag, similar to the poverty stats, the homelessness statistics are about 5 months old, I think, roughly, by the time they're published. They allow for a significant comparison across different local authorities. But I think the reason I'm bringing this as an example is that it's so hard in the policy landscape, in the social policy landscape, to really attribute changes in data to specific interventions, even if you can kind of drill down to what there's significant numbers of people accessing services at a local level. And for the homelessness data, you know, along with a lot of other statistics, there's gaps. And one of the things that is really missing from that data is voice, people's voices. And maybe that's where the local planning... this is maybe indicative of what the lack of awareness of kind of the mechanisms at a local level is, that I'm using different language every time I mention that, and I apologise. But that maybe that's where the community planning mechanisms can come in, to really kind of engage and hear the voices of people who are missing from the great quality data that we have.
Thanks. Kirsty.
Yeah, I know today there's been a lot of talk about data and how there's so much data, but in relation to ethnicity in Scotland, we actually have a lot of challenges with data availability, and that's at a national level and is obviously exacerbated at a local level. For example, we can't see what the poverty rates are by ethnicity in local authority areas, and that obviously creates a challenge for community planning partnerships to be able to take those actions to improve outcomes. So as I've kind of highlighted, actions are not targeted at Black and minority ethnic groups, but even if they were, they would struggle to have that level of data to see if the improvements were being made, as well as the complications that Ruth has pointed out as well. And in terms of targeted interventions, I think I've said we really don't see any targeted work to address inequalities faced by Black and minority ethnic communities, and that means that gaps can theoretically widen. But I would say that there's an opportunity for targeted interventions to take place, as I kind of highlighted earlier on, if there were more interventions aimed at aimed and focused at communities of interest alongside geographical communities.
Thanks for that. Marie, do you have any more questions?
Just the last question, but I think, again, it's been covered, just really what the biggest challenges and barriers to CPPs making impacts the Community Empowerment Act anticipated. Anybody wants to just come in on that?
Anything to add, anybody, on that one? No? Oh, Peter's got, he's got an additional...
I guess it's just final comments, really. I mean, the community planning partnerships have been tasked with a really significant role and significant challenge. I think the biggest challenge they face is the resources that are available to local partners to actually deliver on the responsibilities that they have. That's a question of the resources that are available from Scottish Government that are available via the UK Government as well. I think that is undoubtedly the biggest challenge we face. Unless there are more resources going into local community planning partnerships and the various organisations around them, then we will struggle to meet some of the long-term outcomes that have been set. So I think that's always the eternal question, is how do we get more resources into the system? But unless we do that, some of these challenges will still be with us, I think.
Thanks for that. I think we're going to move on to theme six, which is culture change of statutory partners, with Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for joining us. I'll maybe merge a few of my questions. And I wanted to ask the panel with regards to your experience of partnership working, where you've seen more collaboration take place, and specifically any shift towards preventative action. And you've touched upon a couple of cases like the Edinburgh and Midlothian ones. But I wanted to see if there's any, especially with regards to resources, if you could present any examples. I don't know who wants to come in first, or
nobody leaping at it.
I'll maybe pick on you, Peter, as you raised Midlothian and Edinburgh specifically.
Absolutely. Again, thank you for the question, and I think it's one of these issues where I feel as though we're in a position to give examples of good practice, because that's where we're drawn to. You know, when we're drawn into those conversations, it's generally from through our local authority contacts primarily, who are wanting to improve practice. So another good example would be Argyll and Bute Council, where we've done a good deal of work with Argyll and Bute to work with a whole range of community planning partners and service delivery organisations to improve their understanding of poverty and how it impacts, particularly in the rural context. So I think you start to see where there's a willingness that's in part driven by the plans that are put in place. You know, the plans, if plans are put in place to see more progress in addressing poverty, and one of the means to do that is to have the different partners working together more closely, then that kind of that drives that collaboration. So in that way, I think the community planning process has been useful in helping to foster that greater collaborative approach. It's still quite difficult, though. I think it's the Argyll and Bute work. I can see where there has been really important changes in the way that they go about developing plans and putting them in place, again, focused mostly on the child poverty theme. But I know from engagements with other third sector organisations in Argyll and Bute, that they perhaps don't experience that same sense of culture change and involvement. So again, it's that same story of how we spread that engagement and those lessons around collaboration out, even within one community planning partnership area. Yeah.
Thanks. Ruth?
I wanted to take it from maybe a slightly different angle and think about Housing First delivery, for example. There's 26 local authorities now across Scotland who deliver Housing First, and the principles that underpin Housing First are about collaboration and the importance of the health sector, the housing sector, you know, everyone coming together to support what the individual's support needs are. So there's examples across Scotland where this is done effectively, where there's the resource and the leadership and the evidence to show that these things can have a significant impact. So it's kind of maybe from a slightly different angle than from a place approach.
Yeah. Thanks for that. And in terms of statutory partners, and you've touched upon them throughout this morning session, is there anyone who you believe isn't included who should be in the original Schedule 1 of the 2015 Act? And on the flip side of that, is there anyone you think should be excluded from those conversations? We'll maybe start on the positive one of included. And if anyone wants to come in, please do.
I guess I had almost a question back on it, which is, for me, there's housing is missing. Housing is an incredibly important foundation for every single person. And the risk of homelessness, the experience of homelessness and the impact that can have for people. So my question back is almost, how do we get housing into the planning, the local planning mechanisms? And is it by requiring a specific part of the local authority to be on the group? It's a question kind of back to you as to what's possible, yeah. I suppose.
Yeah, and not just this act, you know, when you look at integration of health and social care, excluding housing as well.
Yes.
It's not then create that opportunity. But no, thanks for that. Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks, Miles. I think, David, you wanted to come in on Miles's previous question. Do you have something? I'm just going to say, please be succinct.
Yeah, I actually won't, because I think Peter and Ruth have probably covered my point I was going to say on the previous question, but just in terms of that, who else could be involved in community planning? It's difficult to legislate for non-statutory organisations, and OTSIs have got a role in community planning, but I think to extend the right to be involved in community planning to local community anchor organisations is well worth considering, whether that's community-based housing associations, community development trusts or the likes. They have a kind of increasingly leading role in terms of developing and supporting community infrastructure. And I think that would be a good positive road to go down in terms of, you know, considering other people to be involved in a more equal footing within CPPs.
And Peter, you wanted to come in?
Just very, very quickly, I think Department of Work and Pensions at local level are sometimes involved and sometimes not, but I think they play such an important part in some of the issues that we're concerned about. I think I don't think they can be required to be there, but I think a more structured engagement would be really helpful.
Thanks. And okay, we're going to move on to our seventh theme, which is leadership and the role for the Scottish Government, local authorities, with Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just have the one question. It's on the importance of leadership. And given the time that we have, I'll just pick on Kirsty maybe to offer an idea or two on it. Kirsty, it's just about, we've heard in the previous panel about the importance of leadership, but it's inconsistent across community planning partnerships, let's be honest. And I think it's a key ingredient to help deliver that locally. Do you agree with that? And do you think we've got enough emphasis placed on leadership and leadership skills to allow community planning partnerships to have some reasonable chance of success right across the board? And I'm afraid we don't have time to go around the whole panel, but I'd be obliged for any thoughts from yourself, Kirsty.
Yeah, I think my answer should be fairly short anyway. Obviously, I agree that leadership is very important in relation to equality and anti-racism. Better leadership is really needed within community planning spheres in order to kind of create that right environment for change. Something specific that could be done is to strengthen the existing guidance for community planning partners in relation to tackling inequalities, particularly as I've highlighted today, in relation to communities of interest, and also just generally ensuring that staff who are involved in community planning have the right equalities, knowledge and competence to be able to deliver change for Black and minority ethnic communities.
Thank you. If there are any other points from other members of the panel, we'd be obliged to, maybe if you could send them in, we're really short for time. So back to you, convener.
Thanks very much, Willie, and thanks. That was a great response, actually, Chris. This panel has been brilliant, actually. I've been making notes. I try not to make too many notes, but just notes on kind of things that we could actually take action on. So it's been really, really helpful. And I do apologise that we got a bit pressed for time. These are the kinds of things that we could talk at length about. But I really appreciate you coming and joining us today. We agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next two items in private. So as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting. Thank you.